Everyone, welcome to our third meeting of 2016 of the Public Petitions Committee. Can I remind all those present, including members, that mobile phones and BlackBerry should be turned off completely as they interfere with the sound system, even when they're switched to silent. The first agenda item is a consideration of whether to take items 5 and 6 of our agenda in private. These items are to discuss our approach to our legacy paper and a witness expenses claim, which we would normally take privately. Members agreed? Okay, so that brings us to our second item of business, which is consideration of PE1463 on effective thyroid and adrenal testing, diagnosis and treatment, on which we'll take evidence from the Minister for Public Health. The Minister is accompanied today by four officials. We're also joined by Elaine Smith, MSP, who has been in attendance and taken a keen interest in this petition, and will allow Elaine an opportunity to join in our discussion. But before we get to that point, I'd like to welcome the Minister and her officials and invite the Minister to make a short statement, after which we'll move to those questions. Okay, over to you.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning. Thank you very much for inviting me to give evidence to the committee on this issue. At the outset, I should make clear that not only do I have an ongoing interest in this petition as Minister for Public Health, but I also have, as I previously made public, a personal interest in this petition. In fact, I was substituting at this committee, I think, in 2013 when it was discussed. So I am aware that there are many people who are affected by thyroid problems and that some of them have been unwell for some time, having experienced difficulties in obtaining diagnosis and appropriate treatment. I'm very sympathetic to the challenges they face. First and foremost, I would like to stress that we take the petition and what the petitioners are saying very seriously. Although I have an understanding of some of the issues that will be raised today, I recognise that the committee may ask questions of a more clinical nature, and for that reason, I will require to refer some of your questions to Professor Graham Leese, the Chief Medical Officer's Speciality Advisor on Diabetes and Endocrinology, who is also an Honorary Professor in Diabetes and Endocrinology at NHS Tayside. As the committee is aware, the Scottish Government commissioned a listening exercise carried out by Thyroid UK surrounding the experiences of hypothyroid patients. This online survey was carried out during the summer of 2015 across the whole of the UK. Respondents were invited to complete the survey from a variety of sources, including the Thyroid UK website, forum, Facebook and Twitter pages. There were approximately 5,000 respondents to that survey, with just over 4,000 surveys fully completed. The purpose of the listening exercise was to obtain a comprehensive picture of what was happening in respect of patients' experiences of diagnosis and treatment. The survey was aimed at patients diagnosed with hypothyroidism, as well as those who had symptoms of hypothyroidism but had not yet been diagnosed. A number of questions were asked covering patient experience, diagnosis, treatment and GP knowledge. The results of the survey are available from Thyroid UK's website, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank the charity for carrying out this useful work in helping us to obtain a better understanding of patients' conditions, diagnosis, treatment and experience. Committee members will be well aware that the role of the Scottish Government is to provide policies, frameworks and resources to NHS boards to allow them to deliver services that meet the needs of their local populations. Within this context, the provision of healthcare services is the responsibility of local boards, taking into account national guidance, local service needs and priorities for investment. It should be recognised that progress in clinical science has been and should continue to be based on proper conducted scientific-based trials that strive to eliminate any error or unrecognised confounding issues. It is appreciated that progress can sometimes be frustratingly slow, but this is the consequence of trying to get things right and ensure patient safety, which is paramount at all times. Anecdote and clinical observation can be useful to raise scientific questions, but such questions then need to be tested rigorously, as otherwise it can be potentially detrimental and dangerous to patients, as well as wasteful in terms of NHS resources, not just in thyroid disease, but also in terms of all other medical conditions. The position statement by the British Thyroid Association, published in May 2015, clearly sets out their recommendations on the management of primary hypothyroidism based on the current literature, review of published positions of the European Thyroid Association and American Thyroid Association, and in line with best principles for medical practice. These recommendations have been endorsed by the Association of Clinical Biochemistry, British Thyroid Foundation, the Royal College of Physicians and the Society for Endocrinology, and therefore reflects current best practice in the management of hypothyroidism, about which Professor Leese will be able to speak more if needed. The British Thyroid Foundation is a patient support group that since 1991 has worked with medical professional bodies such as those listed above to provide guidance for all patients and their relatives who have thyroid disease, including those with underactive thyroid, overactive thyroid, thyroid cancer and thyroid eye disease. The British Thyroid Foundation have endorsed the British Thyroid Association guidelines. In addition, the British Thyroid Foundation has written a frequently asked questions sheet for patients and published that on their website. Guidance has also been written for GPs, which is expected to be published later this year in a GP-orientated medical journal. So in conclusion, convener, I am aware that the petitioner has met with SINE representatives and that an outcome of this discussion is that the SINE Council is hoping to determine in conjunction with the Royal College of Physicians whether it may be helpful to seek to produce a good practice guide on the topic for general practitioners. This, of course, will ultimately be a decision for the SINE Council, and the Scottish Government can't influence this decision, but I welcome their consideration of this proposal. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Minister. That was a pretty comprehensive overview of the situation from your point of view. As you said at the outset, this is a petition that has been running for a substantial amount of time. Members who have been on this committee have had an in-depth understanding of it as it's gone forward, and I know some of them are keener to get in and ask questions to follow up the work that they've already done. So I'm going to go to the Deputy Convener first, David Torrens, to ask the first set of questions.
Good morning, Minister, and thank you, Convener. Returning to the Thyroid UK survey report, the survey found that 42% of respondents considered their clinician was not open to discussion treatment options, and over 50% considered the GP's knowledge of hypothyroidism was poor. How is the Government going to react to these findings, and what recommendations is it going to put in place?
Okay, so as I said in my opening statement, the survey was UK-wide, so we can't extrapolate the Scottish situation from that. And it wasn't a randomised sample, as you would normally expect to do in a sort of clinical trial. Many of the figures quoted, the people responding to the survey will have been those that are very involved in it. So the figures quoted are likely to be an overestimation of the situation. So GPs and endocrinologists generally follow evidence-based diagnostic guidelines, which are agreed in the specialist community. In terms of what the government are going to do, as I said, the government can't intervene directly, but SINE are proposing to develop a good practice guide for general practice. And perhaps, Dr. Leese, Professor Leese, you're involved in that, so would you like to say something more about that?
I'm not directly involved with that, but we have been involved with the British Thyroid Association, and as the Minister mentioned, the British Thyroid Foundation, which is the patient group, have developed a number of frequently asked question responses for patients, and which is also useful for GPs. So I think in response to what's happening, there's been a number of ways forward to try and help increase the awareness of these issues across general practice and across specialists.
Yeah. Elaine, supplementary just on that specific point?
Mind, because it's relevant to that point. I might have asked it later, but it's maybe better if you don't mind, convener, to ask it now.
I'll come back to David.
So it's just on the British Thyroid Foundation. The petitioner tells me that they've actually recently changed their advice online, I think as recently as maybe just this week. And what they're now saying, probably directly to Professor Leese, if you don't mind, Minister, but what they're now saying is that for some people, then it would be okay to try T3. So I would quite like your opinion on that, because obviously it's okay to try it, but you have to be referred to an endocrinologist by your GP first, because GPs won't prescribe it for you. And secondly, that it's okay for T4 now to be slightly over, that's now acceptable. And finally, that whatever medication you would be taking should be one that resolves your symptoms, which of course brings up the whole issue again of desiccated thyroid hormone, which is allowed to be prescribed on a named patient basis, but very few GPs will prescribe it. So I would just like some comments on that, please.
A comment on the British Thyroid Foundation. I'm not sure I've seen the document you're referring to, but it probably referring to the British Thyroid Association guidelines. And what they suggest is that, which is nothing new, is that certainly the blood tests are not the whole picture. It's when you're replacing someone on thyroxine, it's a balance between treating symptoms and treating the blood tests. So the blood tests give you a range with which you should be within for terms of safety. But within that, you can move around your dose of thyroxine as long as it's kept within that safe range. And that's perhaps more explicit in the document. That's always been the case. In terms of the use of T3 or liotironin, there is scope within the British Thyroid Association document that was published in May for the use of liotironin in exceptional circumstances. That's also stated in the European and American guidelines. As I say, in exceptional circumstances, if it's felt that it's going to benefit the patient. And as you say, it may need a referral to an endocrinologist for that.
Well, if I might just come back briefly, convener, I wonder if you could also comment on the range, because it is different. This is something that the committee's been looking at. It's different in different countries, and far too often I think we've heard evidence and that GPs just rely on the blood tests and they don't actually look at the patient's symptoms particularly. There are a lot of patients on many other medications treating symptoms actually if their thyroid was treated correctly. They wouldn't have to be on all of these other medications, including things like drugs for depression, for example, drugs for fibromyalgia, painkillers, etc. And if there was better treatment for thyroid patients, more treatment that was more centred to them, like, for example, the way it is with diabetic patients, then obviously there could be moves forward for patients and for the NHS, the scope there for the NHS to be saving money. And so I further wonder, why is it that diabetic care, which is a fellow endocrine neighbour of hypothyroidism, is treated as, it's treated on a person-centred basis, whereas those with underactive thyroid are simply put on level thyroxine. That's the basis, one medicine for them.
I think the evidence would suggest that actually the patients on thyroxine are treated very much at an individual level, and that the guidelines and most GPs would try and adapt the levels according to symptoms, as long as it's within the safe range according to the blood tests.
So maybe for people who are not so involved in it, convener, anybody on levothyroxine gets a blood test every year, TSH test, and if there are abnormalities in that test, then you're tested for T4, and if there are still abnormalities, it may be tested for T3, is my understanding of it. So routinely, patients on levothyroxine do get an annual blood test to see if there have been any changes, and the dosage may be increased or indeed may be reduced as the blood test shows.
I think
think also it's worth noting that there's a wide range of what's acceptable TSH, so that there is scope for moving doses, perhaps to small amounts, to maintain patients within that wide range of TSH, which is thought to be safe. So there is scope.
Your question in there?
Okay. Thank you, Convener. The Minister mentioned in her opening statement that there would be new guidelines published later in the year for GPs. Can you expand a bit on these guidelines and how quick will SIGN implement them?
Only third part of that. Could you just repeat some of that?
And say that again, please.
There's some noise at the background, right. So I'm sorry I didn't hear.
How quick will SIGN implement these new guidelines for the GPs?
There just needs to be an increased general awareness of these guidelines, and I think that comes down to educating GPs, advertising the guidelines. Every GP has to do a certain amount of professional development every year. There are opportunities there to educate GPs, and they have a huge number of different areas to cover, but thyroid disease is one that can be put into that.
It is something that, you know, most GPs will definitely come across in their practice. But I think on the other side of that, you know, there are these websites from the British Thyroid Foundation and others that people who take levothyroxine should be aware of, so that they know, just like Diabetes UK has got the tests on there for people who have diabetes and what they should be getting from their GP, then I think awareness of patients is important as well.
Minister and your team. I accept what the Minister says about the figures in the report, that they're UK-based, so it's not clear about what is the true picture in Scotland, and I think perhaps the Minister might consider doing a report of her own in Scotland to try and determine the actual figure. But also in terms of time frame in making doctors aware, I think that's important. I don't seem to get a feel for a real time scale in this. What are the time scales that you're participating in, which you intend to circulate this information for GPs so that they are equipped with all the information that they need and the support they would need to then carry that out?
I mean, it's not just a one-off thing. These guidelines are available, have been available since May, and it's a matter of continuing, like any advertising campaign, that's what it comes down to, in terms of increasing awareness. You have to keep at it and keep educating GPs. The philosophy of treating patients within a range of TSH and perhaps changing their dose is not new, it's just re-emphasised in these guidelines.
Stepping around the issue, you're still not giving me a clear guide on how you're focusing on this, how you're homing in on this, how are we going to assess the success of the advertising campaign that's going to be taking place. I mean, surely you will be looking for facts and figures of how successful the campaign is going to be and in what timescales you're looking to achieve those in. I'm wanting more clarity in how quickly you hope to deliver it on the ground.
Can I maybe come in here? I mean, there are already SIGN guidelines for GPs. What we're talking about is perhaps revised SIGN guidelines for GPs. But it should also be said that one of the petitioners has been involved in seeing whether the current SIGN guidelines and any future SIGN guidelines should be altered. And in fact, as a result of discussions, it was discovered that really current SIGN guidelines are pretty good, and that if left to the petitioner, she would probably have come up with more or less what's out there now.
What so, rubbish! There's no guidelines. You have no idea what you're talking about. This whole thing is a
public gallery, please. Sorry.
So,
Minister, we just stop for a second, just to. Sorry for the disturbance. If you want to carry on now, Minister.
Sorry. So, as I say, the petitioner has been involved in discussions about sign guidelines, which is my understanding. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in on that. And the Royal College of Physicians, through the Sign Council, will be issuing new ones in the near future.
I accept what you say, and I'm sure that you're going to try and determine to make sure that it's fit for purpose. But what I'm pressing continuously, and I'll stop at this stage because this is my third attempt, and that is I'm clearly looking for some sort of program that you have in terms of time frames and when you hope to achieve this, because without actually having a time frame, it's going to be open-ended, and that surely is unhelpful.
I think what I said in my original statement is that it's not up to the Scottish Government, it is up to the Sign Council, and you know, we can't really determine their time frame.
Funding them.
Perhaps add to that in that the guidelines are out there. They're in the process of being distributed at the moment. You talked about measuring the success of that. I would welcome your thoughts as to how you measure the success of that.
Shall I respond to that, Chair?
You've got an answer.
I'm happy to do that. In a bit to try and help, I've already indicated that in terms of figures, we don't have Scottish figures. So we really need to, in terms of how many patients there are and how many patients are actually benefiting from the service and how well it's being delivered in terms of the GPs and practices, how much information is actually available to them and whether it's being successful or not in the delivery. End of the day, it has to be measured. Everything needs to be measurable. If it's not measurable, then we cannot judge its success or failure. We do not know whether we need to change things or not, or do we leave a status quo. I understand that the guidelines is...
I think Gonzalo's making a very good point, which I don't think you've clarified at all here. We're relying on this thyroid UK survey.
Could I answer the
I'm just straight. Asking, I'm just enhancing the question, if you don't mind.
Okay. Yeah, fine.
You know, if I make a point, you can respond. I'm not stopping you from responding. I just want to add to what my colleague has said, because I want clarity around this as well. You're relying on Thyroid UK survey. There is, within that, evidence that people have been refused treatment for T3. Now, you're accepting the survey. You're accepting that there are, you know, issues within the survey. The question that's being asked, I think, or certainly what I'd like to add to the question that's being asked, is given that we don't have a full picture in Scotland, yet you're dependent on a survey which you consider yourself not to be complete, why are we not trying to complete that picture? You're working on the basis of a survey which doesn't give you the answers, but you're not actually doing anything, from where I can see, to achieve those answers. Why not?
First of all, to answer, we do know exactly how many patients there are on thyroxine in Scotland. We know how many there are on lyothyronin as well.
Being denied or refused treatments which they are asking for?
No, we don't. And we don't know from the Thyroid UK survey either, because it's...
We don't know from that survey, but you're not telling us how you're going to try and find out.
Can I say that there are about 6,500 patients in Scotland on T3. That's 1% of people who are on thyroid medication. But there is no supporting evidence to support the routine use of thyroid extracts, the T3 monotherapy, or the compound thyroid hormones. So, you know, I think you're giving the wrong impression that a patient can just ask for T3 and routinely be put on it. That's not the same.
With all due respect, Minister, I'm not giving any impression. I'm asking, if all of the work that we're discussing here, if all of the understanding we have on this situation is primarily based on a report which you yourselves consider to be incomplete, the question I'm asking is, why are you not trying to complete that understanding of the situation?
We didn't say it was incomplete. We undertook to undertake a listening exercise, and we commissioned the British Thyroid Foundation, Thyroid UK, to undertake it. And that was they did it across the whole of the UK. So we know from that survey what patients think about their treatment, and as a result of that, the specialists have taken forward the signed guidelines.
I'll let you come in again. I know you've got lots of questions, but other members of the committee, we'll come back to you. I will not miss giving you the opportunity to ask questions, but some of the colleagues have been waiting for a period of time now. Angus and then John. I will come to you, Lee.
Okay. Thanks, Convener. The Minister just mentioned that there's 6,500 patients on T3. Now, we know that there have been supply issues with regard to T3 in recent months. We also know that Mercury Pharma is the only licensed manufacturer of T3 in the UK. And I would suggest there's clearly issues with regard to Mercury Pharma having a monopoly on supply. In light of the supply issues, is the government aware of any action that's been taken to evaluate the improvements to Mercury Pharma's manufacturing process of T3 tablets? And is there likely to be another UK manufacturer of T3 coming forward in the near future, which would clearly assist in the supply? And the other point would be, if there's 6,500 patients on T3, is that limited because of the supply issues? Could there be more on T3 if there was more available?
So there were previous supply issues of T3. An action has been taken to evaluate the improvements to Mercury Pharma's manufacturing process of the T3 tablets. But as you will know, regulation of supply is reserved to the UK government, and enforcement of the regulations on supply is a matter for the Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Authority, MHRA. We're not aware of any issues in regard to the supply of the T3 tablets at the moment, but I don't know if the chief pharmacist would like to come in.
Yeah, just to clarify, so we know the number of prescriptions that are dispensed for T3, and that is 6,500, and we do know, so our Scottish officials are in regular contact with colleagues in Department of Health who will work with the manufacturers, and there have been no supply issues at all in 2015. They have been in contact with the manufacturers to make sure that they improve their processes to ensure continuity of supply for patients so that we don't have the problems that we had a couple of years back. So work has been undertaken to try and resolve some of those issues. In terms of this company being the only company that produces the product, that really is a commercial decision that a company would make. And maybe because there are, comparison to the 2.5 million that there are for T4 prescriptions, you can see that it's a small proportion. So it's a decision that a company would make, not the UK government, to actually produce this medication. But there have been no supply issues in 2015, and active steps have been taken to make sure that the manufacturing process is improved to ensure continuity of supply for patients.
Part of my question was, are you aware of any other manufacturers who may be looking at it? But you may not be able to answer that.
We are aware from our colleagues, and I think it's probably a commercial one as to whether company would decide to manufacture it or not.
Okay. With regard to natural desiccated thyroid, now this might be a bit of a naive question, but I was wondering would it not be simpler, a simple solution to the current issue, which leaves the personal liability of the prescriber or the GP, the onus is on them if there's any comeback. Would it not be a solution just to approve it and allow it to be used without any comeback on the GP, which may be a reason why very few people are actually being prescribed natural desiccated thyroid, and I think people are even buying it off the internet, I believe, because of that specific issue.
Well, there are some physicians that prescribe lyothyroxine, as it does have a licence, but there's no robust scientific evidence, clinical evidence for its benefit, and significant theoretical concerns have been raised about its long-term safety.
Plenty of evidence out there in the wide world that it's working. So,
I think the professor would say it's anecdotal, but I'll hand over to you, Professor.
I'm sure the patients would certainly vouch for the fact that it's working.
Okay. I mean, perhaps put through a few of those issues together just to try and get clarity. I mean, I think everyone would agree that there are patients on thyroxine who don't feel well. So, you know, that is recognised by everyone in the professions, and that's highlighted in the Thyroid UK survey. The issue really is not so much how many or whatever, it's what we can do about it. And as you were saying, it comes down to anecdote versus clinical evidence. And as was said in the original statement, in that 11 out of 12 trials show no benefit of lyothyronine in patients that are feeling unwell on thyroxine. The one trial that's been done with desiccated thyroid showed no benefit in a randomized controlled trial. Having said that, there are anecdotal reports, and I think the position that we try to take as a professional group is to listen to those anecdotal reports, but to try and take them forward in a scientific way, which is what's happened with these randomized controlled trials. But at the moment, they do not support, in a controlled clinical environment, the use of these other agents. And that's kind of this position that we're at the moment. But that doesn't stop us doing more clinical trials, perhaps trying to look at specific patient groups within that area who may benefit from these drugs. But at the moment, we do not have that evidence. And all the guidelines I've mentioned earlier are evidence-based guidelines, because that's the way clinical practice works at the moment.
Okay. And the other thing, convener, is that, you know, the guidance does advise that patients who remain symptomatic should be referred on by their GP to an endocrinologist for further investigation. And of course, you know, some people in the thyroid who live with hypothyroidism or thyroid problems will say that that's not happening. But the committee did hold an evidence session with SINE in November 2014. And the committee agreed to invite SINE to consider developing further guidance and guidelines as a result of that.
Okay, thanks.
Jackson. Oh, sorry, John first, sorry. And then Jackson. Sorry.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Minister. Just a couple of questions about the work of Thyroid UK and the survey that was produced. We note from the preface, and you also made reference, Minister, that the Scottish Government commissioned this research. Could I ask, how much did this research cost?
I don't have a figure for that. We could certainly get it to you.
In terms of the commissioning of this research, was there no guidance given to the Thyroid UK regarding the extrapolation of Scottish patient experience in the terms of the survey? Because it's, as both yourself and Professor Leese have both said, you can't extrapolate from this report the experience of patients in Scotland. Yet the Scottish Government commissioned this report without asking specifically to get the details of Scottish patients' experience. This committee has been asked in the petition to deal with the experience of Scottish patients. And clearly, while, and hopefully the Minister will provide the committee with details of the cost of this commissioned piece of work from Thyroid UK, but clearly there is an issue here in terms of who commissioned this work and why the work did not focus in on the experience of Scottish patients in relation to their treatment and the diagnosis regime that currently exists in Scotland. And I'm hopefully Thyroid UK will be able to take this to the UK government and make good case for actually better treatment regimes in the UK, in England and Wales. But clearly, this committee is concentrating on the experience of patients in Scotland, and it would have been useful, extremely useful, and whoever drew up the commissioning document, to actually say to Thyroid UK, can you break this down and give us Scottish figures in relation to the areas that you've identified? And clearly that never happened. So hopefully, Minister, you can come back to us with the cost, but maybe you can come back to us as to why specifically you did not ask in this commission piece of work what the experience of Scottish patients in terms of the treatment and diagnosis in relation to the petition that we're dealing with.
Well, maybe we could go back a step, because I think some people were under the impression that there would be a short life working group set up, but I think my predecessor advised the committee in a letter on the 5th of February 2014 that there was no evidence base to support the changes that were being sought by the petition at that time. So instead, we asked for a listening exercise to be done by Thyroid UK, and that resulted in the survey that they undertook. And as I've said previously, it was through their website, Facebook, Twitter, and so it wasn't a survey in the sense that you would have a specific group of people that you would ask. That's not what the exercise was meant to do in the first place, but we can certainly send you details of the cost.
My colleagues just said to me, the convener, why not in terms of the situation that we're looking at in relation to the decisions that have been made since this petition was received by this committee in 2012. Clearly, and we heard earlier the frustration of the petitioner in relation to some of the responses that you gave yourself, Minister, and we'll examine that further as a committee. But the decision to commission a piece of work by the Scottish Government to identify the issues, and you talked about a listening group. How do you establish a listening group if you then take examples for the rest of the UK when we're trying to deal with Scottish examples in relation to patient experience? Because there may be, and we do know across the UK, there may be different experiences in different health boards and different guidance that's issued. And you've mentioned the sign guidance that will be issued, and you can't instruct sign how to give that guidance. But clearly, Minister, the Scottish Government has a role to play within this. We have asked as a committee the Scottish Government to examine the patient experience and the medication that's being provided to patients and the benefits of that medication. And yet you've spent, don't know how much yet, and hopefully we'll get the figure, but you've spent money asking an organisation to conduct a survey that, is, quite frankly, to paraphrase yourself, is you're basically saying isn't worth the money that was spent on the report, because it doesn't give us anything conclusive in trying to take forward the issues that have been raised in the petition.
Well, I can say to the member that I'm not aware what the parameters were of the listening exercise that was undertaken. As I've said, I'll undertake to write to the committee how much it cost and what the parameters of the listening exercise were. However, I doubt that the experience of patients across the UK might be all that different in terms of this. Indeed, given the state of the health service south of the border, it might be worse.
I have, like one or two colleagues, been following this petition since it was launched in 2012. And it was the aim of the petitioner that endocrinologists are able to accurately diagnose thyroid and adrenal disorders and provide the most appropriate treatment. That was where we began. I've got to say, Professor Leese, although your words are very carefully couched, essentially the solutions that patients are looking for, you seem to me to be branding nothing more than quackery. And yet, thousands of women are clearly not benefiting or are unwell from the routinely prescribed treatment of T4 in Scotland. And although you say the evidence is only anecdotal, I'd love a definition of anecdotal, because anecdotal can be a little woman at the bus stop who said she read it in the Daily Express, who found it in Hello magazine, or anecdotal can be the first-hand experience of thousands of women who have been prescribed and who have said that the allergic reactions that they had or the symptoms that they previously had had been alleviated and they were now well. It's also, so it seems to me that there is, I don't want to call it a professional conceit, but it almost seems like there is a predetermined establishment position which a survey, which was meant to be part of a listening exercise, which it now seems was the listening exercise, which I understand involved multiple patient groups with diseases, not just the one that we're looking at, is now used, and I think the Minister said at one point, and I was a little astonished, in respect of the survey, those who responded were very involved in it, so that might explain why it was weighted as it was. Well, what was the point of the survey if it wasn't involving people who were very involved in it? Naturally, I would expect that to be the outcome. And it seems to me that after 3.5 years, there is an establishment, and I've heard this in relation to other things, and nobody wants people to prescribe things that are unsafe, but this anecdotal charge, I mean, you talked about clinical trials. Where were these conducted? How many people were involved in them? When were they conducted? What is the real substance in the face of, I don't think, trivial evidence to us as politicians, but the real life experience of many women that seems to me to direct that there ought to be a process by which we try to do more by way of prescribing alternatives?
Yeah. You give me the impression that you think there's a conspiracy theory behind all of this, but in reality, I think if you speak to any clinician, 99% of them, they will...
come from? I mean, 99%? I mean, that's like me at least saying 99% of the parliament. Where did 99% come from?
I mean, if you've got 6,500 people being prescribed, then doctors are clearly making decisions to give women this medication. So how can you come up with a figure of 99% of people believing that the survey you've got is the accurate position?
I'm sorry, I don't think you're listening.
Well, I asked you where 99% came from.
Where did the 99% come from? We've had figures bandied about all morning about the number of people who are being prescribed, and you just pluck a figure out of the air to justify your position.
Was 99% perhaps an anecdotal percentage?
What I was saying was... the majority of clinicians, is what I said, are
so
actually...
it could be 51%. Yeah. So not 99, could be closer to 51.
I'm not quite sure what I'm being asked.
I'm asking you where your figure of 99% came from.
Of what?
You said that 99% of clinicians agree. Where is that 99% established?
I said, what did I say? I didn't say 99%.
You did.
I said... no, I didn't.
We're not going to agree on the figures, so can we just get the...
What I was trying to say is that the majority of clinicians, and what I was saying is perhaps 99%, because there may be the odd one that isn't, and then I was interrupted. I mean, that is just typical.
I'm asking you, where does your 99% come from?
Every time I try to make the statement, I get interrupted.
No, I'm asking you specifically...
Well, can I finish my statement?
No, I'm asking you... you're actually responding to my question, and I'm asking you where your 99% figure comes from.
What?
You have said that 99% of clinicians believe. Where is that 99% verified?
No, I never said 99% of clinicians believe. I said What? Can I please finish this sentence this time for the third time?
Uh-huh.
I said the majority of clinicians are compassionate, is what I was trying to say. No, that's because I kept getting interrupted.
No, you didn't. I think it was a good while after you'd made your point that Jackson asked you to clarify what you were actually trying to say.
Well, I hope this is on tape.
It's all recorded, so we'll be fine.
What I was saying was the majority of clinicians, and then I was about to say, because there may be the odd one that isn't, but 99% of clinicians, and that's when I got interrupted, and I was going to go on to say, will be very compassionate about the problems that patients are facing. So that is what I was trying to say, and that's what I'm trying to get across, okay? So the fact that there are comments about conspiracy theories and quackery, I don't think is fair, in that the majority of clinicians will be upset when they have patients in front of them that have ongoing symptoms despite being on thyroxine. But there are a number of different possible reasons for that, and I can go into them if you want, but there are a number of different reasons. And the other thing we need to be thinking about is that these clinicians don't want to be doing any harm with any treatments that they may prescribe or recommend as well. The other comment I would like just to get across in terms of the issues about anecdote is that that is exactly why we do, that's why we listen to anecdote, because they often raise good clinical questions, which then, as I said before, need to be tested in a clinical trial to make sure that it is actually going to do benefits. And an example I can give you for that is if you look at a completely different disease area in painful neuropathy, we do trials giving drugs for pain, and to do that you'll give half the patients the active drug and half the patients a placebo drug, because that's how you know which one's benefiting, and they're blinded to know which one's getting. And in those kind of trials, up to 50% of patients will get pain relief with placebo. And that's why we need to do these clinical trials to see whether drugs really do benefit or whether there are other aspects of the care that they're giving that help patients. And that's why I come back to the compassion that patient, that clinicians are wanting to show, and in the majority of cases do show their patients. So those are the points I was trying to get across. So I'm sorry if I got
I want to pursue that point. Specifically then, you refer to the clinical trials. Where were they conducted? When were they conducted? How many women were involved?
I can't tell you the exact numbers. There were thousands of patients involved in the trials.
Is this an anecdotal response?
No, just my
You
knowledge.
Don't know is the answer. Perhaps thereafter you could write to the committee giving us full details then of the clinical trials. I don't want to know what you think. I want to know what you know. When were they conducted? How many were involved?
Well, I said I didn't know the exact numbers involved.
Right. Well,
they were conducted between 1999 and 2008, I think was the last one, and thousands of patients involved. One trial showed a benefit, but the other 11 in randomised controlled trials did not show a benefit. There have been four meta-analyses
And where were they
undertaken
conducted?
Across Western world and America and and the UK, and the meta-analyses, four meta-analyses combining these trials didn't show a benefit.
Right, but you can forward that information to us.
I can do that.
Okay.
Could I just answer Carlo's question about the listening exercise? We've got to remember that hundreds of thousands of people live with thyroid problems, probably on thyroxine, and live perfectly well and healthy lives. But what we said in relation to the listening exercise was that those most motivated to reply and answer the questions that Thyroid UK posed are likely to be those most unwell and most unhappy with the service that they're getting from their clinicians at the moment. And what we're trying to establish is the best way to take those concerns forward for those patients who are still feeling unwell, suffering from thyroid problems, but may be suffering from other problems as well. And Elaine Smith is right that most clinicians look at the whole person and the type of drugs that person may need may not necessarily be related to their thyroid problem, and I accept that totally. So hopefully in the guidelines that, you know, these kind of issues will be highlighted for GPs and through the various thyroid organisations, help patients in the type of appointments and discussions that they have with their GPs, and if they're passed on to secondary care to the endocrinologists.
Colin.
Thanks, Convener. I really don't know where to start. If the Minister thought I said that most clinicians looked at the whole person, then that was a mistake if I did say that on the record, because that's not what I'm saying. What I think I said was that GPs tend to look at blood test results and not the whole person. The point that Professor Anthony Toft has made is don't look at the blood results, look at the patient, listen to their symptoms, work out from there what you should be doing. So that's one issue. The issue about the other drugs that they're on are often they're on them because of their thyroid problems, and that if they were on the right medication for their thyroid, then they may not have to be on antidepressants, pain meds, etc. So that's one point. My second point would be that, obviously, petitioner was rather upset. I think maybe the Minister, I don't know if you were perhaps wrongly briefed, because the petitioner didn't, as far as I understand, come to any agreement about guidelines. In fact, she's not aware that there are actual guidelines for thyroid conditions, and she was interested. I don't know if the committee would be interested in getting a copy of those actual guidelines that are in existence at the moment. I think that would be interesting for everybody to see them. So that's the first thing. Also, I suppose it then brings us to the issue that, is the Minister confident that the current treatment for hypothyroidism can be considered safe when it's admitted that 10% of patients who remain unwell on level thyroxine, that's what's admitted. Now, personally, I would say it's a lot higher, Minister, because the professor talked about people on T4 never coming back and saying they're unwell. But actually, I know lots of them who do, and they don't know. They don't think it's related to their thyroid because they're told, here's this little pill, take it for the rest of your life, you'll be absolutely fine, and we'll test you once a year to see how your bloods are. And it's not routine to test T4, it's not routine to test T3. It's certainly not routine to test T3. So I wonder what you could say to, A, the ones, the 10%, which is a modest figure, who are not doing well, what are we going to do for them? What could we say to the people who are not being diagnosed because they're maybe slightly out with the ranges, and actually if they were in America, they would be getting diagnosed? What do we say to all of the people in this country who we don't even know how many there are, who are buying desiccated thyroid hormone off the internet? And why is it that desiccated thyroid hormone was fine until the pharmacy invented T4? So I think these are questions that really have to be answered about how patients are going to be treated in future.
Well, I don't think that I, as a politician, should be saying what the medical profession should do. That's up to the medical profession. But I think I ought to be clear that there is guidance for patients and for GPs and endocrinologists at the moment. There are no signed guidelines, but there is guidance for them at the moment. And what is being developed is, as Professor Leese said, whether there should be sign guidelines. So there is a difference between guidance and guidelines. But I'll let Professor Leese answer your other questions.
Yeah, I mean, there were a lot of questions in there, but I think I hope a lot of the answers may be within the British Thyroid Association guidelines, which are actually very similar to the European and American ones. You don't think so?
I'm afraid not, because I don't know how you feel about this. It's anecdotal, but the problem is, as you would put it, the problem is that for lots and lots of, mainly women, obviously some men, but mainly women, it was something you said earlier, that they could go back if they're unwell. But the problem is that they go back if they're unwell, and it sounds like, now, I've been through all this myself, so that's why it's anecdotal. Sounds like depression. Here's some antidepressants. It's probably your weight. So let's see if you can go on a diet. Or your fibromyalgia is actually something we can give you cocodamol for. So it goes on, but it never, ever comes back to the fact that actually it's your thyroid. And for me, it went on for 2 years. And the 2 years, I had brain scans, I had blood tests, I was tested for Lyme disease, I was tested for lots and lots of things. I was tested for, I was put on heart monitors. It must have cost a fortune, because instead of sending me to an endo, I was sent to a neurologist. I didn't have an endo at that point. I was eventually told I'd ME and I wouldn't accept it. So I demanded that my GP, and even though I was very, very ill, I'm quite assertive, so I demanded that my GP send me to Dr. Anthony Toft. Within one session with him, the blood test for the T3, I wasn't converting. I was put on T3. 6 weeks later, I was much, much better, and it's taken me, you know, even till now to actually get the doses right of the T3. So this is what's happening to a lot of people. I know women on T4 who tell me about all these other symptoms and they think, oh, I'm all right on my thyroxine, my T4. But actually they're not, because all of these other symptoms are down to the fact that they're not on the right doses, or they should be on T3, or actually desiccated thyroid hormone, which was the treatment previously for so many people and was considered safe when it was the actual treatment. So I think these are the things. I think what women really, and maybe what the petitioner is looking for, is that patients are listened to. GPs use, as I said earlier, the named patient basis to prescribe what is best for the patient, to let patients try out what they want to try out and not have to buy it off the internet, which is very, very dangerous. So I just wondered how you feel about that, because you talk about trials, but there are so many people out there that you won't reach because they're not in the group that you're going to be looking at.
I mean, I think what your personal case that you describe, there is actually provision for what you went through, and so there's provision within the guidelines to address your issues now, and they may not have been in previous guidelines, but the modern ones do actually, you know, you would, in an ideal setting, go down the line that you eventually did go down. So the guidelines would address your particular situation.
The point, convener, I understand that there's about 20% of people, and that's a bit anecdotal, but I don't have these figures in front of me, but there is a high percentage of people who've been diagnosed with ME who actually have an existing underactive thyroid condition. I would like to know whether or not you would consider that those people should all be tested for not converting their T4 to their T3.
Well, if that was the case, if they weren't converting T4 to T3, the TSH would go up.
The TSH isn't the be-all and end-all. I think it was the Minister said earlier that GPs can test the T3 and the T4, which they don't routinely. If a patient is presenting with these symptoms, my TSH, I'm getting into all the details, my TSH is not at a level just now that anybody other than the endocrinologist who's been dealing with me for years would let it be. But I'm doing well on the T3 that's now been upped and the T4 that's now been taken down. So what's happening with me is it's not my TSH blood tests that are being looked at. It's me that's being looked at, and it's how I'm dealing with it.
I'm going to get any further pursuing that line of questioning, Elaine, but I think we've given the situation a good airing this morning. I would suggest to the committee that because we've had such an amount of information and a lot of questions that have arisen out of that, that we need to write to the Minister to get some clarification around those points. We can come back to a meeting. If we can get information back from you that's been raised this morning so that we can discuss it at a future meeting. We're beginning to run out of time in terms of the meetings that we have, but I think based on the questions that arose from the evidence that we got this morning, there is still a bit of distance to go with this petition, and I think we have to pursue this quite diligently as we move forward. So we are pressed for time, and I think the clerks and your officials can discuss the timescale by which we need to get answers back, but we do have to get them reasonably quickly. I don't think we'll have time to invite you back, Minister. I don't think that's going to be possible in this session of Parliament, but I think it may be that our legacy paper will suggest that we do have to keep an eye on this petition, given the number of questions that keep arising and the failure to arrive at a conclusion. I know that you came along this morning to try and be as helpful as possible, but I just think we ended up with more questions than answers. the best of intentions, I think, that you had to give us the information just led to more questions being posed by the committee. I won't comment personally on the style of the evidence session this morning, but I think there might be a degree of dissatisfaction with that as well. So getting the answers in a written form might help us to get some progress on this petition, because I don't think that we got exactly what we were looking for this morning, and that leaves us disappointed. So we have to continue to pursue this. Elaine, have you got a suggestion?
Very briefly, Convener, thanks very much. Obviously, I think there was some misunderstanding, which sometimes it's better to get things in writing, between guidelines and guidance from endocrinologists, etc. And so I wondered whether or not, given the petitioner's been pursuing this for nearly 4 years now, if she might be afforded an opportunity to come back and give some evidence on the information that you received.
It would be difficult to suggest that to a future committee. I mean, obviously, we'll have to wait and see, but that option's always on the table. But certainly, further consideration of the petition is something which is merited, and I think we can guarantee that. But it wouldn't be for me to tell a future committee who they should and should not invite to give evidence. It's just not the appropriate thing for us to do, but I certainly think the committee as a whole can continue this petition and suggest in its legacy paper that future work requires still to be done in relation to that. But we can, as I said, if we can get the written answers to the questions that arose this morning so that we can have a further consideration of this in this session, I think that would help us to direct the legacy paper towards the future committee so that this can continue to be looked at.
As soon as possible we can after we get them.
Thanks very much, Minister. Thanks very much to your team who came in front of us this morning. Thank you. I'll suspend for a few minutes while we change witnesses over. Her third item of business this morning is evidence on a number of, from a number of health boards on PE1568 on the funding, access and promotion of the NHS CIC. I welcome to the meeting Katrina Renfrew of NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, Dr Hugo Van Worden of NHS Highland, Dr Harpreet Coley of NHS Lanarkshire and Professor Alex McMahon of NHS Lothian. The members have the usual briefing and background materials on this petition, which will allow us to ask questions. But before going to our witnesses, I just would like to point out that paragraph 4 of our briefing note should refer to inpatient integration cover beds rather than homeopathic beds. With that, we will move straight to questions. Does anyone want to kick off questions? One that's been raised with me around this new facility at Gap Naval. If health boards have decided not to put funding into the support of CICs, and there are people with chronic pain who are already being treated within your health board areas, where will they then be treated? Okay, Katrina.
I think that there's a number of different strands around the Centre for Integrative Care. There's a national chronic pain service being developed, which will be available to all health boards, and that's a new service. Then there's the homeopathic service that's also part of the Centre for Integrated Care at the moment. And then there's a range of other services, including mindfulness, CBT, some allergy treatments. So there are a range of different services. And I think chronic pain is the one that boards will expect to get from the centre when the new contract is in place with the Scottish Government. Just the chronic pain specifically.
Okay, so specifically, what is it that health boards have decided they do not want to fund then?
I think that's probably better for the three health boards to answer, because there are shades of difference in that.
If I can start off in relation to NHS Lanarkshire, our board took a decision in December 2014 to stop referrals of patients to the Centre for Integrative Care, which includes interventions, including homeopathy, but a range of other interventions as well.
Can you tell me why? I mean, what was the rationale? Is it just funding, better use of the money, or is there a clinical reason underpinning that?
Absolutely not. It's not due to the issues of cost. As the papers which we've made aware to the committee make clear, the decision by the board was taken on the totality of the evidence in relation to homeopathy, but also other interventions provided by the Centre for Integrative Care. It was based on the evidence and not the cost.
Can we maybe get a clarification from the other two health boards?
In terms of NHS Lothian, NHS Lothian still refers patients to the Centre for Integrated Care, so that wasn't a decision that we took as part of our process of consulting on homeopathy. So that still continues, and we have a service level agreement with NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde on that. There is a process for people being referred that exists within NHS Lothian, so it's on a case-by-case basis.
Yourself? Doctor?
NHS Highland took a decision in 2010, a board paper was taken, which took the position that homeopathy wouldn't be continued to be funded by NHS Highland Board. We have a clinical advisory group who looks at all referrals, and so there's the opportunity for individuals to make a case to be referred anywhere, and that those cases are referred. And over the last 5 years, we've made about 2 referrals a year to the Centre for Integrative Care, but those referrals have not been for homeopathy. There have been a few, 4 or 5 requests per year that haven't been supported by that committee. So there hasn't been a recent change in relation to NHS Highland's position. The position goes back to a board paper in October 2010.
Just for clarification, Dr. Coley, could you tell me, you made the statement the Lanarkshire Health Board didn't make any referrals to the CIC. Could you clarify whether that is any new referrals, because I'm sure that we have heard in evidence before at this committee that Lanarkshire Health Board would continue to allow the treatment of patients who had previously been referred prior to the decision being made by the board. Is that the situation?
I can confirm that's true. As with other service changes, if there are patients who are already receiving a service, we continue that, and that's the case.
On that basis then, Dr. Coley, could you tell us what evidence the board heard that was conclusive to make the board take a decision to stop any future referrals to the CIC?
As part of the process, we undertook a review of the literature, the world literature, on interventions provided by the Centre for Integrative Care. That included homeopathy, but a range of other interventions as well, on the basis of discussions that we had with the Centre for Integrative Care. They were on the review group that we had. We looked at the evidence from other reports. We undertook a survey of GPs. We undertook a survey of a selected sample of patients attending outpatients at the two outpatient clinics in Lanarkshire. We made available literature about our process of consultation to those attending the CIC. We took on board comments from the Centre for Integrative Care, from the clinicians, and patients who attended the CIC as well. And beyond that, the board decided to do a wider consultation in which just under 6,000 individuals responded. The board considered the totality of the evidence in that, including the evidence of the effectiveness of not just homeopathy, but the other interventions offered by the Centre for Integrative Care. And the board came to a decision, not an easy decision, but a decision that we should stop new referrals to the Centre for Integrative Care from Lanarkshire.
Dr. Coley, can I ask, in terms of, you've mentioned a number of groups and organisations that you went to as a health board to seek advice, information and reports. Could you tell the committee what the response from the patients in relation to the surveys that were carried out by the health board? Because we are supposed to talk about the health boards and the health service talks about a patient-centred approach to care and treatment. So it would be interesting to find out what the patients themselves thought about the services they were receiving and the decision by, or potential decision by, the board to withdraw the services, not only in terms of referral to CIC, but withdrawal of services in Lanarkshire Health Board completely in relation to homeopathic treatments.
As the board paper, which you have access to, makes clear, and indeed the minutes of the meeting, we made it clear, we were open and transparent about the feedback that we had from patients, not just patients, but from the public. It's undoubtedly true that homeopathy and the other interventions provided by the Centre for Integrative Care are popular. They're acceptable to patients and the public, but that does not mean that they're effective. Otherwise, there would be no need to have organisations such as Scottish Medicines Consortium.
I need to ask this question because you said the treatments are not effective. Who makes the determination whether or not the treatment is effective? Is that the patient or is that the clinician?
I think if you look at how the effectiveness of interventions is measured, you need to have high quality studies, you need to have unbiased studies, you need to look at the literature that exists, not just within Scotland, the UK, but worldwide. That is one part of the evidence that the board took on board. They also looked at the feedback from patients. And as I've said, we made it absolutely clear that patients and the public find homeopathy popular and acceptable, but that does not mean it's effective. And if I can continue, I would just point out that if that was the case, there wouldn't be a need to have organisations such as the Scottish Medicines Consortium. There wouldn't be a need to have organisations such as SIGN producing guidelines or NICE, because these organisations assess the effectiveness of interventions. Yes, it's important to take on board the views of patients and the public, but if we're looking at effectiveness, we need to do that.
I think if you'd have been in for the previous session that we've just had, Dr. Coley, then I think you'd have heard the committee, I think, unanimously agreeing that some of the guidance that's out there and the SIGN guidance does not deal with the issues that patients are dealing with. And what we're trying to, as a committee, I think, look at, and in terms of this petition, is look at the benefits that are given to patients in terms of their treatment, in terms of their care, in relation to how they feel, that makes them participate in as an active life as possible. I'd like to move over, convener, to the situation in terms of the Centre for Integrative Care in relation to the continued viability of the centre. If we had, what we're hearing today, is that, with the exception of Lothian, is that health boards are withdrawing referrals or not making referrals to the centre, how financially viable is Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board in terms of maintaining the level of services for patients who may desire those services, despite the fact the local health board is not making a referral?
There's two different elements to that. One is the routine business, if you like, that we call cross-boundary flow, where the other health boards fund us for the services that their patients use. We need to look at the loss of income, and we need to look at how we reduce costs to reflect that loss of income. But I think the view we've given the committee is the centre and the services it provides are still viable, because the majority of them are used by NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde residents. So there's a piece around the centre that's about cross-boundary flow. We've also indicated our own intention to review the centre in terms of the services it provides, their costs. In part of our own financial planning for 16-17, we've got about 40 or 45 different service reviews that we'll be running over the next few months in order to set our budgets for 16-17. So there are two different processes at play, but we've been clear that the viability of the centre is not threatened by the loss of cross-boundary flow income. It means we need to reduce costs because we can't afford the service to run exactly as at the moment, and we are doing a wider service review of the service in terms of financial planning for next year.
But at that point, then, just for clarification then, from your perspective, how many other health boards have signed up to make referrals and will be providing funding to the CIC?
I think there are only two or three boards that send no referrals at all. And as colleagues have said, other boards do have cost per case arrangements where their residents can flow through on an assessed basis. Our population is nearly a third of the Scottish Health Service, and we're using about half the capacity of the Centre for Integrated Care. So in our view, the viability, while NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde continues to commission it, is there. It may be a smaller service because there are less patients coming in from elsewhere. But I think we have confirmed to the committee our view that despite that loss of income, we will be able to continue to run the service, subject to our own review of the service as part of our own work around what services we provide.
To a situation that if you're providing essentially the core funding to have the facility there, if other health boards are only using it or buying into it on a case-by-case basis, and others have decided not to refer at all, that makes it very difficult for you to plan future funding and maintain the funding that's required to ensure that the service is there, should anyone or anyone from any other health board wish to access the services that are provided?
We work with other health boards on three-year arrangements to give some stability to the flow of finance and referrals, and we have arrangements, cross-boundary flow arrangements, with all of the boards that use our services. It's not an unusual arrangement where some boards buy one aspect of a service and others don't, and there's different volumes from different boards. So there's nothing unique about the centre in that regard in terms of the cross-boundary flow arrangements that we run.
Jackson?
Morning. Can I ask, just by way of introduction, just a clarification question.
The new National Centre for Chronic Pain, which will be located there, the Cabinet Secretary confirmed this to Parliament in 2014. Where is that currently in terms of its development within the facility at Gartnavel?
Detailed planning is being done literally as we speak. There's been a series of discussions this week. There's been engagement with the public and patients, so that work is going ahead.
The fact is that with regard to homeopathic medicine, there is no national position of the Scottish Government in relation to whether it's a good thing or a bad thing or whether it's provided or not. And so it's been left to every individual health board to take a view as to whether or not this is something that they wish to be to support. Some health boards have never, in fact, I mean, we're focusing on Dr. Colley, who's one that did and now has chosen not to, but some health boards never have. I'm interested in the inherent contradiction in all of that, because if I can ask you again, Ms. Renfrew, clearly then Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board do believe that it has merits, and in essence, Dr. Coley's position was that they had taken peer group studies of the effectiveness rather than desirability of homeopathic medicine across the wider world, and I'll come back to him in relation to the judgment of his own patients, and had concluded that it wasn't effective. So there's then, it seems to be, an essential contradiction between the views of different health boards, because if Glasgow are committing to continue to provide the service at the CIC, Glasgow must have concluded that it is effective, otherwise it wouldn't.
As Dr. Coley said, that any health board doing a review like this looks at a whole range of factors, public opinion, patient opinion, an evidence review, and the board will weight those factors in making a decision. And different boards do weight those factors on a whole range of services in different ways. So you will find a different pattern of health services in Greater Glasgow than in other areas, because there isn't a single scientific correct answer when you take on board patient opinions and public opinions and so on. I think the evidence base, as Harpreet's described it, is clear, and that was one factor that Lanarkshire considered when they made their decision. We will review the services at the centre again. What we've said is it's financially viable as it stands, because the majority of its work comes from NHS Greater and Glasgow and Clyde. But we do need to look at the decisions and the reviews that have been done in other health boards and revisit whether our position is the correct one, and we'll be doing that.
Well, I'm not quite sure where that leaves me in relation to the commitment, as I understood you were giving it to the centre. I'm asking, is it the view of Greater Glasgow and Clyde at the moment, since they financed this treatment, that it is effective?
We last looked at this service in detail, I suspect, about 10 years ago. And we concluded then that we would actually stop providing homeopathy, and the board reviewed that decision as part of a process where there was a great deal of public anxiety and anger, and patient anxiety and anger, and took the view we would continue to provide it. On the strict definition of effectiveness, I think the evidence in the way Dr. Coley's described it supports Lanarkshire's position. But there are a number of other factors that were considered in reaching that decision, which is now several years out of date, and we will look at the work other health boards have done in revisiting our own conclusions. I was making the point the centre is financially viable. That doesn't mean it's not subject to review, along with almost everything else we do as we go into 16-17 and need to set a balanced budget.
No, I appreciate that. Given the pressures there are on NHS resources, I suppose I would be slightly concerned if we were investing in services that you didn't ultimately conclude were effective, if I can put it that way. So I find the conundrum a difficult one. If I ask Dr. Coley, you talked about all the international evidence, and then you talked about your own, you said that you had contacted, or you had taken advice from those patients that you had referred. How many of them said that the treatment they had been ineffective?
Been ineffective.
Ineffective.
Most of the patients that we contacted said that they thought the treatment was effective. That's their opinion, yes.
So, coming to the conclusion you did, it was actually in spite of the evidence from the patients that you had referred, and was largely drawn from the various other peer groups that you read.
As I said earlier, the board took on board a whole variety of evidence, including the literature on effectiveness. What individual patients say is important in terms of acceptability, in terms of whether they think that that's something that they want. It does not show that it's effective.
But the majority of them said it was.
They felt that they had benefit from it. And the board took that on board. That's noted in the paper that we presented to the board. But critically, the board looked at the totality of the evidence around, not just homeopathy, but for other interventions provided for the Centre for Integrative Care.
I understand the argument that goes on around homeopathy. I guess just when I'm presented in a committee like this, if you'll forgive me, with professionals who are taking these decisions, I mean, I do find that a slightly ironic position, that the patient base that was referred, from whom you can take direct evidence of the effectiveness of the treatment they received, said yes, it was, but you have discontinued it notwithstanding that, because there is a totality of evidence from elsewhere that says it isn't.
Precisely the reason why there are organisations such as SMC, such as SIGN, such as NICE, to assess the effectiveness. Importantly, yes, it is important that feedback from patients, from the public, form part of that. It doesn't answer the question about effectiveness.
Okay, well, I suppose I would conclude it wasn't important at all what the patients said, but that's me. It was set aside at the end of the day. It was set aside. Their views were set aside in favour of this broader evidence. Is it just that you needed to save money and this seemed like an obvious way to do it?
No, it was not about cost. It was about evidence. As a doctor, as a director of public health, I can emphatically state this was not about cost. It was about the evidence. This was not an easy decision for board members to make, because here we have two elements of the quality strategy, if you like, in dissonance. The evidence that we have about the effectiveness of interventions and patient-centeredness. The board members and the discussion reflected the difficulties that that poses.
Can I ask what the consequence of not referring patients to the Centre for Integrated Care has been? Because clearly thereby they must have been put down some alternative treatment, and I suppose that must have had its own consequence for the various service provisions that those patients will now be taking advantage of in terms of their initial appointment, but possibly more importantly, since I know that that can very often be met within a time scale, the subsequent treatment that they receive. Have all of the patients who would otherwise previously have been referred, what is the prognosis for them?
We made clear in the consultation document that if the decision was not to refer new patients to the Centre for Integrative Care, that they would have access to other services. And we have ensured that they have access to psychological services, to the chronic pain management services, to self-management programmes within Lanarkshire. And we have monitored those since we stopped new referrals to the Centre for Integrative Care.
What has your monitoring told you? I understand they have access. We all have access in the sense that, you know, if that's the provision of the health board, it's easy to say you have access. In practical terms, what has the monitoring suggested in terms of the impact it has had on the timious nature of the treatment people receive?
Our monitoring has shown that patients who may have been referred to the Centre for Integrative Care previously have been referred to these other services, and that there's no additional pressure on those services.
Okay, so all of those patients will be being treated without it having created any additional delay to their treatment or the treatment of others?
They have been offered alternatives, yes.
Okay, thank you very much.
Elaine, to be followed by Hanzala, and then John.
Thanks, Convener. I'm getting a bit of deja vu with the thyroid meeting. First of all, just going on what Jackson was pursuing there, Actually, it was over 80% of the public consultation that wanted the services to remain. So I suppose the first question I would like to ask Dr. Coley, because I'm interested in Lanarkshire and I'm particularly interested because the clinic in Coatbridge stopped, was, so in relation to democracy and the patient's charter, do you think that it is right just to ignore that number of people?
This was a consultation. It was not a vote on treatments provided by the Centre for Integrative Care. And the board, when it made its decision, took on board that it has a duty of best value, including investing public funds on interventions that are based on sound science and evidence. So it was not a vote. The board had to make a difficult decision based, as I said, on the totality of the evidence, and it was mindful of its duty of best value.
Okay, so you do a consultation and then basically what happened was the people who responded were ignored because it wasn't a vote, it was just a consultation. So it seems to me that what people responded, that you just ignored it. So can I move on then to the other thing that Jackson
no,
was pursuing?
No, we did not ignore it. That was brought to the attention of board members and it's noted in the minutes of the meeting. That's why it was such a difficult decision to make, because you're weighing up the evidence from a whole range of different sources. That's why it was so difficult.
Actually, it's why personally, convener, I think it should have been referred to Scottish ministers. I think MSPs who were representing people should have been involved more in the decisions that were taken. But the other issue is about the conventional services now, where the patients are now having to go. And we did see, you know, I've seen a plea from a Lanarkshire patient who it was given to me. It was actually said in the response letter to that patient from Heather Knox that, regrettably, there's continued increasing demand for chronic pain services in Lanarkshire, which is outstripping the current available capacity. So does that mean that because more people are now forced to go to these other services, that you're actually, these delays are now becoming commonplace? And is it acceptable for people to have delays for their repeat treatment?
In terms of chronic pain management services, you're right. We do have challenges, just as we have challenges in a whole range of other services. We've improved that service, but there's more work to do around that. And I can let you know of a range of things that we've undertaken to improve the access to that service. In relation to psychological services, which is the other main service, Lanarkshire is the best performing board in terms of patients waiting for treatment. They have access to a wide range of services, including self-management services. But you're right, we have challenges in providing the whole range of services, but that's true not just of those services where patients who would have been referred to the Centre for Integrative Care have been referred to, but other services as well.
Dr. Coley, are you aware then of actually how many patients the chronic services are having to cope with since the withdrawals in April 2015 and how many extra staff, if in fact you have put on, if you have other staff to deal with this, how many extra staff do you have in terms of clinicians and nurses?
Firstly, in terms of patients, to get the precise number of patients would need a review of and a survey of patients, which is not possible, but we have taken on board the comments from the service itself in terms of the pressure on those. We've employed additional staff in terms of a nurse specialist. We've created additional capacity in terms of medical input. We've revised and reviewed and remodelled the service model, so it's a community-based model rather than a hospital-based service. And we're piloting with three GP practices a community service.
Have you looked at those the extra costs then before you took the decision to not refer? Did you look at the extra costs that there would be on the other services? You said that it wasn't possible to review. I just wonder why it's not possible. Obviously, I know that repeat patients are not, well, initial patients are going to be given the guaranteed waiting time, so they'll be dealt with, and that will include the patients that are moving over from CIC services. And so basically, is that why repeat patients aren't being considered?
When I talked about costs, I said the decision was not based on cost. We did consider the impact that it would have on other services, and that's exactly what we've been monitoring.
That doesn't sound like a meeting of MSPs with Lanarkshire Health Board. We have got witnesses here from other health boards, and I'm interested in how they arrived at the conclusions they arrived at, because they appear to be different. But what I want to understand before going into other colleagues' questions, did you carry out similar consultations? Did you have the same access to the extraneous considerations? And can you suggest why you might have arrived at a different conclusion? Other than there's something in the air and the water in Lanarkshire that arrived at a different conclusion, what made you arrive at the decision you did, so that we can get an understanding of why we seem to have this differential?
Do you want me to?
Professor McMahon.
Okay. So when we did our consultation in 2012, we did open it to people, the public, staff, any other stakeholders. Almost 4,000 people responded to our consultation. 75% of them said we shouldn't provide homeopathic services in NHS Lothian. Like Dr. Coley has said, when the evidence was presented to the board, it was the totality of evidence. It wasn't just those people who responded to the consultation. It was the worldwide literature that was looked at as well in relation to that, in terms of the board's making that decision. In terms of the decision about continuing with the SLE, with Greater Glasgow and Clyde about CIC, that was in relation to specific therapies, not the totality of homeopathic remedies. And the majority of the patients that we send at the current time are receiving mistletoe therapy in particular, which is more for end-of-life care. So that's a specific service that the CIC. But we wouldn't deny the opportunity for any patient to be referred. That still stands from that point of view. So we don't uphold every referral. Those are looked at clinically, individually. So that's where the slight difference is. But in terms of the process, it's very, very similar to that that Lanarkshire undertook.
Dr. Van Wert.
Well, as I say, this issue was discussed at the board in 2010. Since then, NHS Highland has a clinical advisory group, and any patient who wants treatment outside Highland, any referral outside Highland for specific treatment goes through that group. And so there's an application process. And so each case is considered on its merits. I am aware that there were a couple of cases in particular that had extensive focus in 2013, which NHS Highland referred to the Scottish Health Technologies Assessment Group in relation to two specific forms of therapy by homeopathy. So, as I say, we have a process for consideration of each individual case.
The original decision on whether to continue with referring, did you conduct a similar type of consultation to the other health boards, and can you give us an indication of the level of support from those who were receiving support or would have potentially received support from a CIC, whether they wanted that to continue, and was it similar to, for example, Lanarkshire and Lothian?
I've only been in NHS Highland for a year, so I'm not part of this history, as it were. But my understanding from the chief executive was that there was support from the GP community for the decision to be made and consultation within wider groups. I don't think there was a formal patient consultation the same way, because the decision was made to have a committee that would consider each request, each individual request. It's a sort of slightly different approach, if that makes sense.
Okay. Hanzala and then John.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to you all. Mr. Coley, I don't want you to think that I'm targeting you, because I'm not. You've been very clear in your responses, and I also respect the board's decision that they took on a lot of other issues other than just this. But, and I'm not looking for Katrina Renfrew to get business from your authority either. But the question that I'm posing, want to ask you, is that whilst people attending the Integrated Care Centre in Glasgow and the patients were happy with the services they received there, the new patients that you're not sending to them, are they equally pleased with the services that you are providing in your own authority? Has that survey been carried out to see the satisfaction level of patients there? And also in terms of the cost implication, is it actually value for money for your authority in terms of keeping patients in-house? I don't know if you have the information to hand, but if you do, it would be helpful.
As, As with other services, we monitor that. In terms of specifically those patients who may have been referred to the Centre for Integrative Care, short of following up individuals in a whole range of services, it would be impossible to track those down. But as I say, we do monitor the services across all the care that we provide. But specifically for that, it would be impossible to try and identify those.
If I may, Chair. Yeah, because I think that to make a fuller assessment of the failure or success of any service or change of any service would determine whether the patient was actually benefiting from the steps that your authority have taken. And if you don't have that, in the absence of that, it's difficult to then assess whether what you did decide, what the board did decide, whether that was actually prudent or not for the patient in the first instance, and then in terms of resource in the second instance. So it'd be interesting if maybe we could get some follow-up information for that in due course. The other aspect of all of this is, I think, which is very important, is the satisfaction levels of patients who are receiving the service. And as I say, without evidence in terms of facts and figures, it's very difficult to then judge whether the decisions that were made were in fact correct and accurate at the time. And also it becomes difficult in terms of assessing the CIC's position in terms of how they will continue to be a viable proposition in West of Scotland. So do you think you are in a position to go back and get us that information? And if so, what sort of time frames are we looking at?
Relation to patients who may have been referred, that's a very difficult study to undertake. And I think that considering the issues of identification, of trying to follow those up, I think that's almost impossible to do in the context of in the context of NHS Lanarkshire. It may be a research project which could be undertaken over a long period of time. That would be quite significant in terms of the resource use that would require.
Chair, it's just in terms of trying to assess whether the decisions made were wise ones and whether the patients who actually received the service benefited from it or not, and whether they were actually value for money or not, can only be done if we have figures to substantiate the end result of this delivery of the service. And
we do monitor the services, particularly in relation to where those patients who may have been referred are being referred. That's to chronic pain management service and to psychological services. And we do monitor those services, not specifically for those that potentially might have gone to the CIC, but more generally. But I think it is important also that we've been monitoring complaints in relation to the decision taken. We've had 3 complaints in relation to the decision taken by the board in relation to stopping new referrals to the Centre for Integrative Care.
And I think I've made my point. Yeah, thank you very much.
John?
Convener, sorry to come back to Dr. Coley, but Dr. Coley, in response to Jackson Carlow and Elaine Smith, you said you made an implication that it wasn't down to financial decision about withdrawing the referral to CIC from future patients in Lanarkshire. But you did make reference to best value. Could I get, then it's a question I often ask those authorities and others who cite best value as a justification for doing something. What is your definition of best value?
As I said earlier, in relation to best value, it's investing those public funds on interventions that are based on sound science and evidence. And clearly, in relation to not just homeopathy, but for other interventions provided by the Centre for Integrative Care, that evidence was lacking. It may be that in the future that evidence may increase, and we made that clear during the board discussions.
You base it on sound science? That's the ultimately the decision that was made was based on sound science, rather than the patient's experience in relation to the treatment that they were receiving. Because I think this is where we get into the debate about what, and I mentioned it earlier, in terms of the patient's experience of the health service versus what clinicians and decision makers think is in the best interests of the patient. And I think we're trying to get to the situation where you've made the comment about you've based decisions on sound science, the sound science as you see it, not as the patients. Now, you also made, in response to my colleague Hanzala Malik, in relation to when he asked whether or not you can measure the effectiveness of alternative services that are being offered by Lanarkshire Health Board to those patients who felt they may have benefited to have been referred to the CIC. You said that you measure the services in general, but you cannot measure the services specifically to an individual patient in terms of their course of treatment. And you said that would involve a large research, I think you said, or you mentioned a research project that would need to be conducted to do that. Why can't you? If you are making a decision and your clinicians are making a decision to refer on to other services rather than CIC, why can you not measure how those patients' journey of experience and the effectiveness of the treatment that they're being offered instead of being referred to CIC?
I see a practical difficulty in identifying patients who may have been referred to the Centre for Integrative Care if we had not taken that decision, because the decision by the board has already been made. So trying to identify those from GPs would be an almost impossible task to undertake because the policy has changed.
That you had received three complaints from patients in Lanarkshire Health Board that would have disappointed the decision that the Health Board took not to allow them to be referred to CIC. The difficulty for many patients is many patients accept the clinical judgments of the professionals, medical professionals, because they don't know what other options there may have been open to them to take. And effectively, Lanarkshire Health Board has closed down the route for many patients to actually receive alternative treatments at CIC. They've effectively closed that down and told in the sound science of the professionals is that they can only receive the treatments that they feel is appropriate in their medical professional opinion rather than, and I go back to the point I made earlier, about a patient-centred approach to treatment. And we talk about the patient being at the centre of the treatment that they feel they require to make them better and make them live a better life. But the reality is at the present moment, and this is a wider issue, convener, for the other health boards to try and understand where the patient fits into this process. Because if we did only take decisions based on the medical opinions of clinicians and GPs, then the reality is many patients, as we heard and as I made reference, and Elaine Smith made reference to the deja vu of the earlier discussion today, that clearly patients' views and opinions and wishes are being denied them because the health boards seem to be closing down an option that was previously available and had been previously available for a number of decades.
I have to say that this is not based on clinical judgments. It's based on the totality of the evidence. We have, when we did undertook our review of all the evidence, we did a survey of GPs. There are some GPs who favour homeopathy. We made that clear in the board report. This was based on the totality of the evidence. And as I said earlier, there are issues, there are really difficult issues here where you have different elements of the quality strategy that run contrary. And the board needed to look at the totality of the evidence, including the feedback from patients and the public. difficult decision to make, but they did that by weighing up all the evidence that they had.
I should actually have declared a personal interest in this, because 22 years ago, my daughter was referred for an operation when she was 2 years old for an adenoids, to have an adenoids dealt with and her tonsils removed, because she continued to present with streaming colds and blocked up sinus. The response from the medical profession at that time was, we will remove the adenoids and tonsils and that will resolve the problem. My wife at the time was attending a homeopathic clinic in Glasgow, and the homeopathic individual there indicated that maybe you should keep your daughter off dairy products and see how you get on. Up to that point, my daughter had been in constant receipt of antibiotics to deal with the problems that she was having. When my daughter went for pre-op, the doctor that saw her said, we can't carry out the operation because she's been on antibiotics in the last 6 weeks, so we can't go ahead. After the visit and taking my daughter off dairy products, the following visit to the pre-op, the doctor said, this is a different child you are presenting to me, because this child is clear of all the problems that we have identified and we were going to operate on. So the reality is, and I'm basing it on my experience of what happened to my daughter when she was 2 years of age. She would have had her adenoids removed, her tonsils removed, and today she's still got her adenoids and still has her tonsils, and she knows how to manage the problems that she had because she stays clear of dairy products. So that's a practical example that I have of someone that an operation that would have cost the NHS money and time to treat was treated fairly straightforward, fairly simply, by someone out with the professional medical profession saying, keep your daughter off dairy products and see how you get on. And that, as I said, is an example of why we need alternative options for many patients in society today. And to close down that alternative options closes down a whole raft of alternative treatments that would actually save the NHS money, time, and patients particularly hardship and frustration about being dealt with.
The only comment I would make is I respect your experience and your views. I think over time, evidence changes, and in fact, we do much fewer tonsillectomies now as the evidence base on tonsillectomy has grown. The only other point I would make is that there are alternatives to patients who are not being referred to the Centre for Integrative Care, and we've provided and outlined those alternatives.
Elaine, you wanted to make one short supplementary. I'll come to you.
Thanks. Yes, just a short supplementary, actually, on that point. But before I do, Dr. Coley said that NHS Board had made the decision, but of course we do know that if NHS Lanarkshire have made the wrong decision, then ministers in the past have actually overturned the Board decision, so we know that that can be done. I was just picking up on what Dr. Coley said there. What I would say is, in these times of stretched budgets, what I would like to know is, why did NHS Lanarkshire not do a cost assessment of the impact of switching these patients to conventional services, the additional staff, etc.? Why did you not do a cost assessment of that?
We were quite clear that this was not about the cost of the service. It was about the effectiveness of the service. We identified costs of around £200,000, as we made clear in the Board paper. But that was an estimate, the best estimate, of the Centre for Integrative Care. And that forms part of the service level agreement that we have with Greater Glasgow and Clyde.
It could be more cost effective to keep the services. The patients want the services, but the Board decided not to keep them.
A fundamental point about cost effectiveness is that the service or the intervention needs to be effective in the first place. And that's why we did not look...
Quiet, please, we're not allowed to intervene in discussion.
That's why our focus was quite clear and the Board position was quite clear. We were interested in looking at amongst other things, the effectiveness of the interventions offered by the Centre for Integrative Care. We did look for cost-effectiveness studies around not just homeopathy, but other interventions. And as we found, very far, few and far between, and indeed work undertaken by Healthcare Improvement Scotland, which looked at evidence on homeopathy, on the clinical and cost effectiveness, they couldn't find that. Notably, the decision on the evidence has been backed up by an Australian review undertaken just under a year ago in March 2016, which concluded there is no good quality evidence to support the claim that homeopathy is effective in treating health conditions.
Okay, Mr. Renfrew. Yeah. Okay, John, just before I come to
that. Clarification, could you tell us who commissioned the Australian study?
The Australian study was commissioned by a healthcare organisation within Australia. They looked at the evidence throughout the world. Pardon?
This is a private healthcare organisation?
No, it's run. It's a government organisation. Yeah. Right. I can provide the details of that, should the committee wish.
Yeah.
To come in for the point for a while now, so over to you.
I think there's a much wider issue than about homeopathy of the balance between evidence and patient opinion, and I think it's an incredibly complex area. And if you take the tonsillectomy example that's been raised, when we did change our policies on tonsillectomies and stopped doing them, you know, to people of my age, no child got to five with their tonsils intact. The policy was if you looked at somebody the wrong way, your tonsils were removed. So your daughter was extraordinarily lucky to live in a different era. But we changed that policy quite rightly on new evidence and stopped doing tonsillectomies. And we had parents objecting and petitioning health boards and saying, I want my child's tonsils out because they're off school again. And the clinical evidence was that was not the right thing to do. So I do think it's a very difficult area of debate, but there are many things that patients want that the health service doesn't provide. And we're very focused on homeopathy today, and I know that's the subject of the petition, but there are a whole raft of alternative treatments that the NHS does not provide because they are not evidence-based. And we do try to cling as NHS boards to evidence as a basis of making decisions, because if we don't, then I think we have enormous difficulties in engaging with patients about what it is that we actually deliver for them.
The point is that occasionally we have been sucked into the idea that this is about delivery of homeopathic services. It's not. It's about, I don't need applause from the gallery either, it's about delivery of integrated care. And you know, I just wonder if, in given that you are the health board, the Greater Glasgow and Clyde are the health board that does provide this facility that we're discussing, how widely do you promote it in order to try and make sure that people are aware that the services are available, that they might then put pressure on their GP to be referred?
I don't see part of our role, to be honest, as marketing services. We, the GPs in our area, know the range of services that we have available, and they'll make decisions with patients about which services that they refer to. We have enough demand for healthcare in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde without actively seeking referrals, but we do make sure GPs are well aware of the range of services that there are. And as I've said, we do need to review the centre as part of our review of all the services that we provide, and that will be happening over the next few weeks and months.
OK, one more, Elaine, before we close it down.
On that point to Katrina Renfrew, can we just clarify then that the review of the future of the Centre for Integrative Care is in light of the reduced cross-border flows, or is it not, just before we wind up this, or the convener winds up the session?
It's a review that we're commissioning on the basis of our overall planning for next year across all our services. So as I said, we've got about 44, 45 different reviews to look at how we can set a balanced budget and meet the needs of our patients in 16, 17. So no, it isn't provoked solely by the cross-boundary flow issue, but that is part of the financial issue that we have. So it is explicitly part of the reason we need to do the review, because we do have less income, but we would be doing it in any event.
Thanks again to all of our witnesses for coming and answering the questions that put to us. Again, some questions have arisen on the basis of the questions that we've asked, and I think we need to give the petitioner the opportunity to hear the evidence we've had this morning and respond. So we'll continue, if colleagues agree with this petition. We'll look again at the responses we receive from the petitioner and anywhere else we get correspondence from, because there are a lot of people following this petition in particular, and we'll have a contribution to make to the discussion that we've had. But I do appreciate that you did come in front of us this morning and answered the questions that we put to you, and we thank you for that. Thank you very much. And I'll suspend the meeting for a couple of minutes again until we change over. of business this morning is consideration of 15 continued petitions. The first of which is petition PE1105 by Marjorie McCants on St Margaret of Scotland Hospice. As you know, Gil Patterson has taken an interest in this, and I'll give Gil the opportunity to comment, but just to point out to members that at our last meeting, we asked for an update on when a meeting would take place between the Scottish Government, representatives of the Health Board and the Hospice. I understand that that meeting has now taken place and that all parties appear to be content with the progress that's being made, even if a solution itself hasn't yet been found. So it's in that context that we're discussing the petition again this morning. Gil, is there anything in particular you wanted to raise with us so that we could add that to your consideration?
Yeah, I don't mind. I wouldn't mind, Convener, just to highlight some points, because I think, and I thank you very much for the opportunity again to come here. I think the accountancy review has got to be done sooner rather than later. And because if there is an inbuilt disadvantage, and I actually think there is, and I'll maybe come on to that just in a moment or two again. But my big concerns in this regard is with the joint boards. And if the joint boards, how will they, what will their notional way of deciding what is the appropriate funding? If you remember that all the different hospices are then in a different place. And if there's an inbuilt disadvantage, then I think it would be very, very difficult for St Margaret's to come up with a cohesive argument to an individual joint board. So I think this has got to be sorted very, very soon. And, you know, I come on to then the difficulty with an accountancy firm. There has definitely been difficulties. And I know that looking at what you've been presented, that it would seem that we're on the way to getting somewhere, but we haven't decided yet on an accountancy firm. And I did suggest the last time, and maybe the committee would endorse it, that we use our weight of opinion to the government that if they want to look outside Scotland to find an accountancy firm, fine, but that might be difficult in itself. Perhaps we should suggest maybe a chair that takes this on board. We'll have maybe a High Court, retired High Court judge who can, you know, appoint an accountancy firm who may have had some contact or contract with the government or with the Health Board. And I think that might, now I'm not speaking on behalf, this is me, not the hospice, I may add. I've not been briefed on that in this regard. But to move it on so that it doesn't get stuck, that might be a solution to it. And, you know, some of the difficulties that I've just went through, some of the information I previously had, because a simple, straightforward thing. I've got a paper here from the 10th of the 7th, 2015, and it shows, if I could just quote, if you don't mind, if you could bear my, if you can indulge me, these are all hospices within Greater Glasgow and Clyde. So we've got the accord, and the funding per bed is £159,891. The Ardgowan, which is £153,083. I don't have anything on Marie Curie, but I've got the Prince and Princesses of Wales Trust, £140,471. We've got St Vincent's, and that comes in at £131,377. And then we go to St Margaret's, which is £53,328. Now, the reason I say that it's the formula that's crucial here, and nobody that I have contacted, including the Health Board, can tell me what the formula is. And so the only way that we can get to the bottom of this is a proper review by an accountancy firm. And I have posed the question, and you can clearly see it's clearly not in beds, because the numbers, again, if I gave you the numbers, I should have maybe, but it's 8, 8, 14, 8. So these are all the other ones I quoted, and it's 26 at St Margaret's, so it's certainly not on beds. So we need to understand what the formula is. Before I move on, before the review, and it's in the paper to you, and I would like to highlight about the appointment, and this is what St Margaret's say. The appointment of a firm of accountants was discussed in light of the fact that many of those accountancy firms approached St Margaret's of Scotland Hospice felt unable to participate in an accountancy review due to the conflict by having carried out work in the past for either the Scottish Government or the NHS. So I think, I don't want that to be a blocker. I do feel that if we can't find someone, that what I'm suggesting might get round that. And it's good that that there is a willingness to share, it should be able to be published if the information with regards to each of the hospices is there. It's public money, so it should be published, and then that will let this committee itself see the figures for themselves and make a judgment. And I certainly would like that, because we're so close, and I know it's coming to the end of this term, and is that there can be a pressure on this committee itself to close. I think we need, before it closes, I think we should see that the outcome of the review is published. And now, after that happens, I'll be content. I'll not come back after that review takes place and the information is published. I won't be coming back to ask you to keep it open.
The committee, so thanks very much for that, Gil. Just to make clear, the committee is under no pressure at all to close any petitions because we're coming to the end of the session. Petitions can carry over. So that's not in our consideration. The consideration I think that the members have got is, what usefully is this committee now contributing to the outcome that might be achieved? And that's what we've got to consider. Is there something else that we can do which is going to allow a solution to be brought in this specific case? We've also got to take on board that we don't adjudicate in individual cases. It's not our remit to do that. What we're trying to do is identify where there might be problems which can be brought to the attention of the Scottish Government or any other authority, for which the Parliament has any jurisdiction, in order to improve administration, resolve wider issues or correct policy. So it's not about whether the issue that St Margaret's brought to us could be continued or not continued. It's whether this committee can usefully contribute to providing the outcome that will be achieved in whatever way the decision's made. That'll be a matter between the government, the health board and the hospice. I'm just looking to the committee to see if there's anything. We've heard Gil make a couple of suggestions about us suggesting a chair or some independent way of assessing this. I'm not sure that we have got the capacity to do that. We could suggest to the government that they have a look at that, but it wouldn't be for us to make that decision. But we could do that and then not do anything else with the petition. I mean, our final say on it would be that there has to be some independent involvement, because we are in a situation which I think has moved on from 2006 when this petition started, that we now have the government committed to review of hospice funding and its strategic framework on palliative and end-of-life care. So things have moved on. It's just that individual dispute over the financing of the beds at St Margaret's hasn't been resolved. But the overall policy and the structure in which it's all taking place is clearly different from what it was when the petition was originally started. So I'm actually looking at committee members to see whether they think there is something useful that we can do to contribute to resolving this. Yes, yeah.
Before, and thanks very much. From my perspective, I think the fact that the petition has been kept open has been what has brought us to where we are. I fear that if it had closed when the government had recommended that the petition had was being closed, I really fear that we wouldn't be where we are at the present time. And I think it would be extremely useful if the committee, just for that simple, straightforward reason, the power of this committee, the regard that's held in by the Parliament has been the thing that has got us to where we are. That's what I really believe.
Well, I appreciate that you can make that consideration. It's just been brought to my attention that the question of seeking an independent arbiter or chair to try and draw the thing together has already been put to the Scottish Government by this committee. I'm not necessarily sure we got a conclusive answer to that, but that's a situation that was already put and it didn't actually meet with any positive response. So again, we're now at a position where what we have tried before wasn't taken forward, but Gil, you seem to believe that just by keeping this petition open it's making a difference. Do the members of the committee believe that that's the case, Angus?
Yes, thanks, Convener. I can certainly see the merit in Gil Patterson's request for continuing to monitor the situation prior to closing the petition with a view to keeping a watching brief and waiting for the outcome of the review of the technical accounting issue that's in dispute. But I think the committee has come to the end of its any influence with regard to this issue, but I think perhaps it might be worth waiting to see what the outcome of the review is and then looking at closing the petition.
Member Jackson?
I obviously want to pay tribute to Gil Patterson and the previous constituency member, Des McNulty, both of whom pursued and led on this issue with the support, I hope, of other MSPs. And there undoubtedly was a very deeply ingrained suspicion that there was a prejudice in the health board, which then led to a kind of mutual animosity between the parties, which meant that, albeit in theory there was a working agreement previously in place, nothing ever materialised from it and time continued to pass. One of the things this committee sought to do was to get the Cabinet Secretary to take a more direct involvement, and that I think was one of the things that she was reluctant, she in the sense of both the Cabinet Secretaries who've held the position, was reluctant to take that direct role and very much sought to have the various parties continue to negotiate to a point. I feel that Shona Robeson has actually more directly intervened and the Scottish Government have been more directly involved. And so I understand Gil Patterson's point about that historical suspicion and the fact that I do think at certain points during the progress of the petition, the fact that this committee continued to take an interest in it was politically resonant. It does seem to me that we are at a point where I'm not quite sure what I would be inviting the committee now to do rather than simply to keep the petition open on the basis that that might still be a productive thing to do. I mean, it's clearly open for a future petition to be lodged in the event all of this goes pear-shaped. But in many ways, it does seem to me that the sword of Damocles, if you like, that was hanging over no longer does, and that the direct involvement of the Scottish Government we sought is now there, and that, in fact, the efforts of Mr. Patterson and others in relation to the future of St. Margaret's have been achieved. So, I mean, I'm not a cheerleader for either proposition, but I find it difficult to see what I would be asking the committee now to do, that's the key.
That's exactly my point, Jackson. I mean, as much as I want to see this resolved, and I want to see it resolved, I mean, I could probably declare an interest as the convener of the cross-party group in palliative care that wants to see the advancement of the hospice movement as much as anything. But we, as a committee, are not involved in an individual dispute between any given health board and a particular hospice, although we can seek to ensure that any issues that come out of that are addressed by the government. And having looked at all of the correspondence and all of the actions that have been taken so far, What I'm suggesting to the committee is that there is nothing useful that we as a committee are actually doing at the present time, which is taking this forward. Anything that's taking it forward is now in the hands of those parties who are concerned. And even the suggestions, just making the point, Gail, even the suggestion you made this morning is something that the committee has already looked at and tried to get on the table. So there isn't, to my mind, anything else that this committee can usefully do which is going to make the situation better at the current time. And as Jackson said, if things do go wrong and there is a failure to agree, the petitioners are at liberty to come back again and raise that issue. But given that the Scottish Government have now got a strategy in which, or a framework in which this is the whole totality of funding is being considered, I think things have moved on. And you know, while there might be an individual dispute between one hospice and the health board, in terms of what this committee can do, I genuinely believe we're at the end of the road. Angus?
Yeah. Can I bring the committee's attention to the letter from Shona Robertson on the 19th of January and her final sentence in which she says, I hope to be in a position to update the Public Petitions Committee more fully soon. Now, clearly, there's still an update to come. So if there's still an update to come, then we should keep the petition open until that's received. Unless I'm told otherwise.
Okay, so the information I have is that the action points on which the petition was raised have been taken forward. And therefore, any response that would come back is just a continuation of the discussion on the action points. Again, we are not actually taking those action points forward now. They already have been enacted.
I can see that, convener. But
we have closed petitions where this, you know, I'm trying to be fair to every petitioner, not just one. Mm. You know, there must be other people out there who say, well, in similar circumstances, the committee closed the petition because they had usefully arrived at the end of what they could do. And they accepted that. They might have been disappointed by it, but they accepted it. But they might look on us and say, well, why are they continually keeping one open in exactly the same circumstances when they're not actually asking for anything more to be done? Yeah. And if we have to be, you know, if anything else, we should be consistent. I mean, occasionally we're going to leave people disappointed, but we don't necessarily help ourselves if we're inconsistent in leaving some people disappointed and not others.
With all due respect, I think we've done a lot. We've gone out of our way in this particular petition. I recall supporting it on at least two occasions when I thought that would probably be the last time it was in front of us, and it seems to be just getting dragged on but not actually achieving anything other than what we've already achieved. So I would concur with what you're suggesting now that I think it's past itself by date.
Yeah. Do other members have a view? Other than Angus is suggesting that we continue, I think everyone else is saying we think it's come to the end of the road. So I don't want to divide. I'm trying to get a consensus. I'm trying to get an agreement. But if we can't get an agreement, we have to make a decision.
Yeah, I can sense that I'm in the minority, convener. So, clearly, reluctantly, I would be agreeable to closing the petition, but very reluctantly.
John?
I'm the same as Angus MacDonald in this one. I have seen this petition virtually all through the process, and I think there is a point at which we have to say, as a committee, yeah, we need to stop. But I think it is that time we say, right, we can no longer take it any further forward. But we have to also bear in mind the Scottish Government have committed to doing things with the hospice and the health board. And I think, and I'm not asking for the petition to be remain open. What I'm asking is, in closing the petition, we remind the petitioner if within the specified period they are at liberty to come back and present a new petition. But we also write to the Scottish Government and advise them that we have closed the petition. However, there were certain things the Scottish Government committed to undertaking in conjunction with the Health Board and the hospice to take forward, and we hope that the board that's been established by the government takes on board the issues and recognises the issues that have been raised by St Margaret's of Scotland Hospice in relation to the allocation of resources to hospices in Scotland. As you said, Convener, there are a number of hospices that may find themselves in a similar situation. But and that would be my support for closing it, that we actually take on board those other issues and we get assurances, but at the same time, close the petition.
Close petitions on those terms before, Jackson?
If we do close the petition, and given the sentence to which Angus MacDonald has referred, it might be that we close the petition but ask the Cabinet Secretary if, instead of writing to the Public Petitions Committee more fully on the progress that's taking place, if she was to write to the constituency member and the regional members in the west of Scotland, who I think were directly interested in the progress of the petition, so that progress at least can be kept alive by the political representatives within the region, if not by the Petitions Committee itself.
OK, I see people nodding. We appear to have reached an agreement. Gil, on a personal basis, can I thank you for the effort you've put in on behalf of this petition? I think it's to your credit that you've stuck so doggedly with it that we're still here so far on making this decision. There may still be issues that this committee will have to look at a future date, but they have to be new issues, and I think that's the point that we're trying to make. There's nothing that we as a committee are actually actively doing at the present time that's going to resolve it, and we've closed the petition on that basis. But the reason why we've still been discussed at this late into this session is because of your determination, so thanks very much for doing that.
I am disappointed, Convener. You obviously know I would be disappointed, but it would be remiss of me to go away from here and not say to the committee, particularly to John Wilson and Jackson Carlaw, but to all the members here, that you've supported me, you've supported the petition, you've seen what's wrong and that something needs to happen. So it would be wrong for me to walk out here and not lay on record my thanks, although I'm disappointed. I appreciate the time that this has been considered and the due diligence that you've brought to it, and I thank you for that.
Thank you. The next petition is PE1480 by Amanda Coppell on behalf of the Frank Coppell Alzheimer's Awareness Campaign on Alzheimer's and Dementia Awareness, and PE1533 by Jeff Adamson on behalf of Scotland Against the Care Tax on abolition of non-residential social care charges for older and disabled people. Members have a note by the clerks and the submissions on this. And Amanda Coppell has written to the clerks to say that she would welcome clarification as to who will be responsible for administering the £6 million fund announced for local authorities to provide free personal care to those aged less than 65 years, and that the objective of her petition remains the same. I'll invite contributions from members. Again, this is one that we could get an answer to and get back if we get a speedy response from the government. We could ask them to get back for clarification on that. Yeah, and then we'll look at that answer hopefully before the end of the session. Okay. The next petition is PE1548 by Beth Morrison on national guidance on restraint and seclusion in schools. Again, members have notes and submissions from the petitioner. Members have any comments on it? Again, maybe just go back to the government just to ask for the assurance that the views of the petitioner and other stakeholders are taken into account. Does members agree that we do that, just to get clarification?
I think also we're at a point where it's open to political parties to decide if they wish to make any specific commitment in relation to the suggestions that are being made in the forthcoming election too. So, I mean, it's not just an issue now for government, it's an issue for the political process, I think, too.
That's a fair point. Okay. So we'll write to the government and ask them to clarify that situation. The next petition is PE1549 by Alan Clark-Young on concessionary travel passes for war veterans. Again, members have a note. Yeah. I think we've tested this one to destruction.
I'm quite happy to close this.
I've wished to support this particular petition just on the grounds that I think this particular petition is an important one, because we recognise the physical and mental contribution our armed forces personnel make to this country. And I think it was a good petition. And I'm not sure how far we can take this now, because one of the suggestions that I would possibly make is that the government needs to possibly explore the possibility of actually getting the transport providers to provide the service without actually getting a remuneration from the government. Now, this may well be a part of the condition of the license that they get in terms of providing the service. Now, I know it's not the job of this committee to suggest that. However, I'm very interested to see or hear from the Transport Minister himself to see if he would be inclined to possibly explore that possibility.
I mean, these things to me seem to be, the negotiations that Amzala's referring to are actually financial transactions, unless what you're really suggesting is that the Scottish Government should be writing to private and indeed public, given that I live in the city of Edinburgh with Lothian, and asking that they do it voluntarily free of charge, which I think would have implications for other service users. It seems to me the government will have considered this.
And therefore,
to be honest, Tanzala, I take your point. I do support the premise of this petition. I think there is merit in what was suggested. The reality is we've asked the government for its position. We have checked out alternatives and made suggestions to the government around those suggestions, and we haven't moved the situation forward. I don't know much more we can do.
Canina, with all due respect, I don't think we've actually specifically asked the government to look at this angle, and I think it's worthy of another shot to see if the government would take up that opportunity. If they say no, that's fine, but the fact still remains that I think that's an unexplored avenue. I think we should do it. I think this is a group of our population that, if anybody deserves it, they do. And therefore, I think another plea for the government to explore that possible avenue is not a bad one to pursue. I'm sure we could make it last another meeting.
I'm with you. I mean, I have to say, my experience of asking bus companies to continue running what they view as unprofitable routes has been fraught with failure throughout my, tenure as both a constituency and regional MSP. I can think of particular bus routes, wanted by the elderly. I can think of claims made in Edinburgh about the inability of pensioners to access Seafield Crematorium, and there's a valid point there, and we've been unable to achieve it. So we may not have a specific, referral back from the government on this, but all my information is these bus companies will say, we run commercial routes unless you subsidise it.
It's the purpose of the Public Petitions Committee to try and change government policy. We're not going to change government policy. We've been told it's not going to change. We've given them suggestions. What you're asking, Hanzala, is for us to ask private companies. I don't think the committee can do that.
No, Chair, I'm not asking for that at all. What I'm asking for is we ask the government to ask the transport providers to consider it. I don't think that's been considered. I think that off-peak buses, and we see many of them that are half-empty travelling up and down our streets, there's no harm in asking the companies to consider it, and which has not been done. And if that could be done, I'd be grateful. All I'm asking for is just a suggestion to the government to see if they could actually explore that possibility.
Okay, do other members have any views? I think you're in a minority of one, Hanzala.
because I think it's important.
I don't want to take it to a vote, as I said. I always try and get a consensus. I
mean, yeah, but Chair, you know, one of the things we tend to underestimate is the sacrifice that our armed forces make around the world, and we're demanding more and more.
I don't think anyone's estimated.
No.
We've had that discussion. I think everyone accepts the premise of the petition. I think the problem we've got here is we've asked the government to support a scheme, a concessionary travel scheme. They've said no, essentially, and we've given them other options. We've investigated ourselves what other options are available. If the only option that's available is to ask the private companies, then what you're effectively doing is asking the government to provide funding for private companies to operate this scheme, which is the concessionary travel scheme, and they've said no to that. So whatever way you look at it, the government would be providing, if you know, the current concessionary travel scheme is the government providing money to private companies to run buses. And if you were just widening the scope of this to veterans, which I support, then it's the same concessionary travel scheme. And the government have said they're not widening it. So you're asking the same question. You're just asking it in a different way, but you're asking the same question.
No, Chair, I'm actually asking it in I'm asking something totally different. What I'm asking is that the government actually wants to ask the transport providers to provide the service free of charge. I'm not asking the government to make a payment. And
but that's how the concessionary travel scheme works, Anzal. I mean, that's...
At the moment, yes.
Yeah. Okay. So, John.
There's wider issues about the concessionary travel scheme, convener, than just about whether or not someone travels free. Because there's the issue of the cards, there's the issue of the administration behind that. There's a number of factors that the Scottish Government, if it's a Scottish Government scheme, then there'll be additional costs. The Scottish Government have made it quite clear they don't, at the present moment, support the additionality of veterans going on to the concessionary travel scheme. And as I said, it's not just about going to bus operators and saying, will you allow veterans to travel free? There would need to be some administration behind that that would have to be carried out and verified by the Scottish Government, which they have said they're not going to do. So I don't, and having dealt with, like Kenny McCaskill said, with some of the bus operators, they're certainly not going to chip up and say, right, we're going to let these individuals travel free charge as long as they produce a card. Because if they were that magnanimous, then surely we'd be saying anybody over the age of 75 or anybody, you know, in other conditions should be travelling free as well. Every bus operator that travels under the bus concessionary scheme or the transport concessionary scheme gets a contribution towards every passenger that travels. And I doubt very much they would allow one group of individuals to travel free charge while the Scottish Government's having to pay for everybody else to travel.
Convener, I'm in agreement with your own position on this. I mean, we have asked the government has said no. It's clearly open to individual members of this committee to make representations to their own political parties with regard to any commitment that might be forthcoming in the manifesto that can be put to the electorate in the forthcoming election by way of a commitment of this nature. But what the committee can do, I think, has now been exhausted because we've asked the government and they've said no.
That's the point, Anzala. If you want to take it to a vote, David, do you want to make a contribution before I'll give Hanzala one final word on it, Bill?
I support a petition, but a government, as Jackson says, it says no, the petition isn't going anywhere else, so...
Okay, Hanzala, do you want to make a final comment?
I take on board what very experienced members are saying. However, I do feel quite strongly about this issue, and I think perhaps the government might want to speak to the armed forces themselves to see if their charities want to engage with the government in terms of taking this petition forward. I think there's still an opportunity. This is our last meeting in this session. Right. So I don't see what the damage will be if we just simply write for this last opportunity to see if the government is prepared to even speak to the armed forces to see if they're willing to come on board and engage with them to take this forward. And if the armed forces are not willing to do so and the government's not willing to do so, I'll accept that.
I have to say, I think that would be just a futile gesture, and I don't I don't think the committee is into doing that kind of thing. Again, sometimes we leave petitioners disappointed, and I'm sure this petitioner will be disappointed he didn't get the outcome that he looked at. I genuinely, as I said...
Mr. Chair, could I suggest that we write to the petitioner to say that perhaps they may engage with the armed forces to see if they can...
I think we do that type of thing. We make the petitioner aware of the conclusion.
Yeah.
And the conclusion is that we've tried our best, the government has made its position clear, and we can't get the solution that the petitioner is looking for. And I think on that basis, we have to close the petition. And that's my suggestion to the committee.
Yeah. Could I also just add one small paragraph to say that if they wish to engage with the armed forces themselves to see if they're willing to engage with the government to take this case forward, if they wish to do so, it might be an avenue for them to pursue it from a different angle.
Can I suggest then that you write to them on that basis, Hansal, and encourage them to do it?
Okay, if you send me all the details, I'll do that. Thank you.
Okay, we'll close the petition on those grounds then. You went down fighting, Hansal. I think the armed forces would be proud of you. Our next petition is PE1551 by Scott Patterson on mandatory reporting of child abuse. Again, members have notes from the clerk and the submissions that have been received. I'll open it up to members to make contributions. What do we think on this? There might be a bit of distance to go in this one, but I'd be prepared for Angus. David, you want to comment?
Sorry.
David, you go first then.
Thank you, Convener. Seeing as the UK government still yet launch its consultation on this, I feel we should keep this open to see what responses come back from it.
Yeah. Angus, were you going to... Members are nodding, I think.
Just to say, I think it will have to form part of their legacy because given the September 2016, before the UK government expects the report, then it would be, there's no point in further consideration until the next session of Parliament.
Yeah, that's fine. I think that's a valid point. Okay, so we'll continue that one and look at it in our legacy paper. Petition PE1554 by Jack Kelly on behalf of Leonard Cheshire Disability on improving the provision of disabled-friendly housing. Remember? Yeah. I think this one's been tested as far as we can. Angus?
Yeah, it's unfortunate, Convener, because I felt at the time the petition did have some merit, but given that there's a lack of support from stakeholders, I don't think we have any option but to... close it.
I have to say I'm surprised at that, but I think that is the reality of the situation, and if we can't get the support from those involved in the area, then there's not really much we can do to take it forward. Okay. The next petition then is PE1558 by John Tom on behalf of RNBCC Crayfish Committee, Ken D. Catchment on American Signal Crayfish. Again, members have had some additional papers in relation to this, but we're fully briefed on it, so members think there's anything we can do with this one? No. Mutterings of content that we've come to it. Jackson?
I'm with Mary Berry. I watched Mary Berry's foolproof cooking programme last night, and American Signal crayfish were a specific item on the programme, and Mary Berry invoked the nation to catch American Signal crayfish and to eat them. And I think Mary is right, and I defy the committee, I defy this committee to stand against the wisdom of Mary Berry on this issue. I do feel that the weight of officialdom in all of this is against the proposal within the petition, and I therefore believe there's probably, notwithstanding Mary Berry's intervention, nothing more we can do. But I am deeply unpersuaded. We are being asked by officialdom not to pursue a petition when there is nothing on offer from officialdom whatsoever by way of any suggested effective measure to resolve the issue that the petition sought to address. And so I feel deeply frustrated because I can see that the petition isn't going to proceed, but I suspect that in another 5 years, the issue will be just as alive as it is today. And notwithstanding officialdom and notwithstanding any action we might take today, I encourage the nation to follow Mary Berry's advice and to catch these signal crayfish and to enjoy their consumption.
No, politicians don't like to be seen to be out of touch with the public. I've heard of Mary Berry, but I've got absolutely no idea which television programme you're referring to.
Clearly, signal crayfish aren't part of your normal diet, convener. Maybe you don't need the advice of Mary Berry in foolproof cooking, such are your own culinary skills, but the nation, I think, takes its cue from her expertise and advice.
Thanks, convener. Perhaps we should follow our Nordic cousins and have crayfish parties in the summer. It might be a suggestion. But I take on board the advice that we've received, and I do think that commercial trapping could result in an adverse effect and an increase in signal crayfish in other areas where they might not be just now if commercial trapping was to be encouraged. So I think we need to close the petition. But in doing so, acknowledge the work that Spice have put into this, because there's been some good papers on this that have been extremely helpful.
Convener, I think we've had some good information about, and the petition highlighted an issue that's clearly a problem in many of the tributaries, and particularly the ponding in Coalbridge. I was surprised that there was American signal crayfish had migrated to, apparently. But the reality is, while closing the petition, I think we need to make the SEPA and other agencies aware that this is an issue that has to be monitored quite clearly. There's no point, because SEPA's response to the committee refers to the European Union regulation about the basically the restrictions on keeping, sale and use of signal crayfish. But what I was worried about in terms of the evidence that we heard from SEPA when they gave evidence in person was that it didn't seem to have any solutions at all, apart from allowing the signal crayfish free rein to populate and continue growth of the population of American signal crayfish to the detriment of every other thing in the system, in the ecosystem. So it is about trying to make sure that when we are closing it, we make these agencies and the petitioner aware that a future committee may be interested in the continuous monitoring of the expansion or wherever we see a depletion of American signal crayfish, because it is very worrying that our lead environmental protection agency seems to just throw their hands up and say, there's nothing we can do about this, and we're not going to allow anybody else to do anything about it. And that may have a major detriment. We just had the opening of the salmon season last week, where there was great play made about the amount of money salmon fishing brings into the economy. But if we allow American signal crayfish to continue to grow in population the way they are, then we won't have a salmon industry, we won't have a trout industry. In fact, most of the river streams in Scotland will actually, where they are currently populating, will actually be devoid of anything other than American signal crayfish. So it's about reluctantly close it, but I think we need to make SEPA and others aware, and the Scottish Government aware. They need to keep on monitoring this to make sure we get some solution in the near future to resolve the problem that we've got.
Okay. So it is closed, but I think we take on board the points that John's made, and we write to organisations to make them aware of the issues that have arisen while we've considered this petition. Our next petition is PE15. Thank you. Thanks very much. Our next petition is PE1563 by Doreen Goldie on behalf of Avonbridge and Stanburn Community Council on sewage sludge spreading. Again, members have information on this. Angus.
Can I first of all place on record my thanks to the petitioners for bringing the issue to the attention of the committee. As a local member, it was already on my radar, and I've been lobbying the government for some time, as has been our colleague Margaret Mitchell on the Tory benches. However, there's no doubt in my mind that the tenacity of the petitioners has helped ensure this spreading of sewage sludge review was undertaken by the Scottish Government in the first place. I'd also like to acknowledge the proactive stance taken by Scottish Water and SEPA, who have, through their actions, helped to limit the inconvenience and distress experienced by my constituents in the Upper Braes area. In the review, there's a number of excellent recommendations, including a fit and proper persons test for anyone holding an operator's licence, tighter, closer regulation, which is overdue, tighter monitoring of operator practice by SEPA, allowing them to intervene where necessary, and I'm particularly pleased to see the problem of waste mobile plant licensing being addressed finally in the review. So, Convener, this is a result for the petitioners, it's a result for this committee, it's a result for SEPA, Scottish Water and the Scottish Government, and I certainly look forward to the legislation being updated sooner rather than later. I do think, however, we should keep the petition open and wait for or ask the petitioners for their view on the review. I know for a fact that they do have some views on it, and I think the committee should listen to these views and feed them back to the government, although I believe the petitioners will be feeding direct to the government. I held a multi-agency meeting quite recently where they've now been given direct access to the government, which they're going to use, basically. So, but I think we should keep it open and get some feedback from the petitioners.
Okay. John?
It was just to support what Angus MacDonald has said in terms of the work of the petitioners. But while the review is useful and the new guidance or the recommendations that have been made in the review will be extremely useful for organisations, I think we need to try and tease out of this review some other issues in relation to the consultation process, particularly with communities. Because while we've had the Community Council have taken this issue forward, there are a number of communities who are affected by the spread of sewage sludge that may not automatically be represented by a Community Council. So there needs to be clearer guidance in terms of how they will make the public aware of the reporting mechanisms that will be in place and who to report to, because that's one of the issues that came up clearly in evidence that people are going to environmental health services in Falkirk, then they were being told it's SNH or Scottish Water. So there's a number of issues there that we need to, and I think the review has gone some way to try and address that. But they also talk about an updated version of the study would be commissioned as soon as possible and published by winter 2016. Given that we're in February 2016, it's whether or not that review could be actually carried out quicker, because one of the biggest problems of sewage sludge spreading is during the summer months. It might mean communities are going through a process of having to put up with it for another summer before we actually get the commission work carried out quicker so that we can get some solution to this. And I was also surprised, Convener, that they actually made reference to only being one licensed site in Shetland for the dumping of sewage sludge. Now, my understanding is that sewage sludge dumping has taken place in other areas, and it would be just to try and tease out with SEPA what exactly is happening or Scottish Water in relation to the dumping of sewage sludge, and can we get guarantees that the illegal sewage sludge dumping will be dealt with in an appropriate manner. Because it's okay to have licensed sites, but where there is unlicensed sewage sludge dumping taking place, then that has to be resolved, and we need to get a proper process in place to allow not only the public to report that, but the assurances that when they do report it, the appropriate action will be taken, and the individuals or companies dealing with that type of situation are dealt with through the appropriate process.
The agreement is that we keep this open. There are still a lot of issues that have to be addressed, and John and Angus have highlighted those, so I think it's entirely legitimate that we pursue it in that way. Okay. Our next petition, PE1566 by Mary Hemphill and Ian Reid, on a national service delivery model for warfarin patients. Members have a view on this one. Suggest that we close it, given that we...
Yeah.
We've taken this one as far as it will go, and there has been some developments in terms of the request that the petitioner was looking for. Members agree that's the case? Yeah. Okay, we close it on that basis. Our next petition, PE1569 by George McKenzie, on the reintroduction of the Scottish Red Ensign. Again? Yeah, this one's been given a good airing.
Jackson. No, I agree. I may express disappointment at the timidity of the Scottish Government in taking forward Scotland's interests in this particular regard, and wishing to remain within the United Kingdom umbrella with regard to the ensign that we fly, but it does appear that since the Government have said they don't wish to pursue it, we have no option but to close the petition.
Okay. I just knew there was going to open a can of worms. Thanks, Jackson. Angus and Zara.
I'll keep it brief, convener. Just to add that it might be worth suggesting to the petitioner that he could well bring the issue to the attention of the Secretary of State directly, if he wishes to pursue it.
We can write to him and make that view known. And Zara.
Chair, I'm also very disappointed. I mean, I know that there are countries who, some would argue, don't even have a navy, have their own flags, and here is Scotland, and shipping and boating people, particularly those who do it as a hobby and who would be very proud to fly their own flag, are being denied it simply because the Scottish Government is not interested in pursuing it. I like the idea about writing to the Secretary of State to see if he's willing to do anything with it. But I also think that the petitioner should be maybe advised that there are other avenues open to them as well in terms of how to bring this forward. I don't know why I seem to feel that perhaps there is, the government's position might be that there are more important things to do than pursue this issue. I don't. I think this is very important. And I think that a lot of people genuinely will be deeply disappointed, and I would suggest that they look at other ways of bringing this back as a new petition.
Well, as I said, we can write to the petitioner and advise them of the thoughts of the committee in relation to that. Jackson's and Hanzala's views can be raised with them, but it would be a matter for a future petition, but we need to close this one. Okay. Our next petition then is, we take two together, they are PE1570 by Alan Lee on parental rights to child contact, and PE1589 by Stuart Curry on an independent review of child contact and financial provision post-separation. Okay. I think the suggestion is that we write to the Minister, letting them know the committee's views on issues for inclusion in the Family Justice Modernisation Strategy, and if the committee has agreed to do that, we could send a draft letter based on that issue, or the issues that have been highlighted in the petition, and then we could wait to see if the Minister writes back.
I can also see the difficulties there. I mean, we haven't taken evidence from, for example, Scottish Women's Aid, who might very well have a view on this, given the harassment that can follow from people who sometimes, you know, a minority. So I do think that there's been, you know, considerable issues raised. I'm aware, both as an MSP and indeed previously as an agent, of some heart-rending cases. But I don't know whether we've gathered sufficient evidence other than to say there is an ongoing issue. Beyond that, I think to come down on one side or the other without, for example, having taken evidence from Scottish Women's Aid, Mairead Teig or others, where there's implications or could be implications on, you know, domestic abuse.
I'm not sure that Matthew's taken a view for or against the petition itself. What we're saying is the petition has raised a few issues. You're
I'm
having
comfortable
a review.
With that, then.
Yeah, you're having a review. I'm sure all of the organisations that you mentioned, Kenny, will have the opportunity to make their contributions. All we're doing is saying, well, we've heard these two petitions. These are issues that came up. It's over to you.
I'm fine with that.
Is that okay? Okay. The next petition is PE1571 by John Beattie on food bank funding. We might just seek clarification on when we expect to have the Social Justice Action Plan, because We made reference to that when it was the petition came up. We can get a response just to get that date, because I don't think we're actually going to get the outcome that the petitioner is looking for. But if we can get clarification around just when we're going to see this action plan, it might help them to see what's actually going to be coming further down the road. Okay. We can look at the petition again in a couple of weeks' time. And the final continued petition today is PE 1584 by Angus Files on a new Scottish Vaccine and Immunisation Advisory Committee. Members have a view on this. John?
I was going to say, while I've got much sympathy with the petitioner, clearly no one else is listening and no one's going to take any other action. So no other option but to close the petition.
Yeah. I think it's quite clear what everyone else's views is, even if we know what Mr. Files' views are. We're not going to make any progress with this one. Okay, with that, we close that petition. And as we've agreed earlier to take items 5 and 6 on our agenda in private, I'll close the meeting to the public now.